Good afternoon. I see familiar faces. I don't know if it means the last time I was not clear enough or people just like hearing my voice, but either way, welcome. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Maimo Kobe. I am an independent consultant to the university, and I'm going to be taking you through this particular workshop. I'm sorry for being slightly late. I was lost, I went to the other side. So I still have to find the place. I'm told that I'm being recorded. So unfortunately, I need to confine myself to this podium. Normally, I walk around, and so today is going to be a bit strange. But anyway, I'll try my best, and I also need to speak into the mic. Sure, this is too formal. It's like I'm a politician now. I'm at the parliament. I'm not used to this. I am not used to this at all. So, just to confirm, we're all here for research project management, am I right?
Yes.
All right. So as I said, that's my name right there. And that's the company that I do this with. That's my own company that I founded. And a bit about me is I have an MBA from University of KwaZulu-Natal, which I did a long, long time ago. And I have an operations management certificate from University of Cape Town. And at some stage in my life, I used to be a lecturer. I think this is better. I used to be a lecturer at some stage in my life. Can I put this here, Mr. Cameraman? Okay. Right, then I don't have to worry about the mic. I lectured at UKZN for 5 years. And again, at some stage in my life, I was a COO of some company in Midrand for 2 years. And I'm also a consultant, as I said. I've been a consultant for the rest of my life. Ever since I was born, I was consulting. And again, I was a CEO. Why are you saying sure? It's too much, eh? And I still look young, eh? Yeah, I was a CEO for a company for 3 years. And now I'm innovation at University of Valley University of Technology. So I'm in the innovation space. I'm a commercialization manager there, but I'm also still doing my consulting work. So that's a bit about me. Oh, by the way, I'm also an optometrist by profession. And yes, optometrist. Yes, in Afrikaans, so yeah, I am that. I'm the chairperson of the board that regulates optometry, by the way, the Health Professions Council of South Africa. I didn't want to include that because she said sure. So I so I was skipping that part, but but anyway, yeah, so that's a bit about me. Now, what qualifies me to do this thing is that I did project management as part of my MBA, and in my optometry life and everywhere else that I worked, I did work in certain projects. Most importantly, or mostly, I worked in project management when I was at an NGO in Durban. I used to work in Durban for 5 years. So we did a lot of projects. And so I have experience in project management. Then the research is when I was a lecturer and when I did MBA. So now I managed to marry the two in terms of taking your project management, the principles as raw as they are, and then trying to match them to research in terms of how it is being done. I've been doing this particular workshop for the past since 2011. That's what, 8 years? Yeah, 8 years. Mostly I did it with UNISA. So I used to do this at UNISA, and I think there was a time when we used to do it every twice every month, because we used to go to all the UNISA branches. So this is something that you guys, I think you have the benefit of getting it when it has been refined based on the questions and comments that I've received when I engaged the different people. So excuse me, I'm a bit sick today. Those of you who remember my voice, you'll see that today is different. It's charming today, no? It is. Now I get charmed. Okay, so we all know, I'm taking for granted that it's project team, okay, because I have strict instructions to stay here and look at you guys. So we all know that a project is a temporary endeavor which will result in an outcome, isn't it? When you take on a project, it's temporary. Doesn't matter if you're going to do it for 10 years. It doesn't matter if it's the how train or whatever the case may be. Bottom line, it's temporary. At some stage, it's going to come to an end, all right? And then you have those outcomes. Research is the same. When you do research, you don't do research for the sake of doing research, and you do it for the rest of your life. And then as you, most of you are sitting here, you're doing research because you actually want to come to a particular outcome and you want to end, isn't it? I know most of you, the outcome is just to graduate. You don't really care about the research results. But the reality is that we need to actually get certain outcomes which include the results. As I said, research is the same, and as a result, research is a project. Now, the whole idea here is that since research is a project, we can borrow from project management and then manage our research. By the way, the whole workshop is not about writing research proposals or anything like that. It's about managing your research project. Okay, so why do we need to borrow from project management? If you take, for example, your Mall of Africa, or most of the big malls and constructions that are happening in the country, especially in private sector, they finish on time. They start, then they will actually say that this thing is going to open in about 2 years or 3 years, and in most cases they finish in 2 years or 3 years, isn't it? Now it means that we can actually learn something from them, because it can't be that these people can actually take complex projects and they finish on time, and then we take research projects which in my view are supposed to be easy, but then we fail to finish on time, and then we do them in 5 years and 6 years. Some of you actually even had to go to the university and plead to say, give me another year, an extra year to complete a research project. So meaning that we can actually go and borrow from these guys and see how is it that we can finish our research project on time. So we need to focus on the completion date, because when you start your research, you're worried about the completion date. In most cases, we talk 2 years, all right? When you do your master's project and all these things, we always say that you registered for 2 years. But the reality is people take more than 2 years. They take 4 years, they take 5 years, or whatever the case may be. I argue that in most cases, you take those number of years because your planning was poor. Because if you really think about it, the only planning that you do when you start your research project is when you write your research proposal, nothing else. You don't really sit down and do a research, a project plan. And the only project plan that you actually include is the one that they want as part of your research proposal, when you actually have your month one, month two, month three. And then that you put as, and then you say that is a plan. That is not a plan. Okay, that is you complying with the requirement of writing a research proposal, but it is not a plan. So the idea is we need to approach it differently in terms of actually having a plan to say that this is when I'm going to start my project, this is when I'm going to finish it, so that the 2 years becomes realistic. It's not the 2 years that you actually just agreeing to, because the 2 years that has been written on your prospectus. Now, we know for sure there's going to be a delay. Unfortunately, there's Mother Nature, there's a whole lot of other factors that you cannot control, so there's going to be a delay. So we need to consider that particular delay. We need resources, all right? When I say resources, at some stage you might find that you need equipment. If it's lab work, you might need people. If you're going to do, you need assistance or something like that, you might even need money. So there are resources that are going to be needed, and then the money aspect is covered by the budget. So the idea is we need to actually find a way of completing our research project within, I mean, on time, on budget, even though there are delays, and using the resources that we actually have at our disposal. Because unfortunately, we do not have unlimited resources. Unless if some of you have connections with the Guptas and all these people that lent at Waterproof. You've never landed a plane at Waterproof, ne? Mm-hmm. All right, so if you've not landed a plane at Waterproof, can I make an assumption that you have limitation in terms of resources? This guy is looking at me and saying, I don't know what you're talking about. No, I don't have limitations. You're okay, now you're sorted. I can see the way you're looking at me to say, no, you don't have those problems. You can't relate. Okay, some of us do have those challenges, so we need to find a way of completing our project within those parameters. So, the whole idea of this workshop is to move you from this guy here to this guy. Hopefully, you'll be happy at some stage in your life when you complete this thing. It is possible to complete on time if you follow the principles that we're going to be discussing here. Now, as a disclaimer, we're not here to learn about project management. All right? We're here to actually borrow some of the tools, the techniques and the procedures that are utilized in project management and see how is it that we can adapt them to research and manage our research project much better. So you're not going to leave here and say that we did project management with Mr. Kofi. I'm going to say no. I will deny that. We only adapted certain tools and techniques and then see how can we use that for our benefit and complete our research projects within 2 years or within the number of years that we've been given. Some of you registered for your project last year and you're still doing proposals. Eh? I know. Yeah, that's all what the students have been saying. But you see, the thing is, the human nature. Yesterday I was talking to someone, was it yesterday or the day before? They were saying that there's a problem with human nature. And part of the problem with human nature is what you're saying, because we always find something to blame. And so once we find it, we blame that thing for the rest of its life. And then you find something else. You see? Now, when you're late, for example, you're going to blame traffic. But the reality is not traffic. You woke up late. No. You knew there was traffic. You see? But then because you found traffic, you say, yes, there's traffic. Then you pick up the phone, whoever you're going to say, hey man, there's traffic. These days they even take a picture, go WhatsApp, and then send you a picture to show that there is traffic because they found something to blame. Right? Now, even with us, with research, when you're trying to do this research and your supervisor doesn't show up once, they miss one meeting. Then you say, you see this poor supervisor. How am I going to finish this thing because the supervisor is poor and so forth, you see. That's the problem. But then what we're going to be discussing, you'll see that certain things like supervision, we actually try to take them into account. And I argue that it's because we don't actually plan that we actually face those things like that. Even the same things with traffic. We know there's traffic, especially this road coming from Mabopane. Then you know you're not going to do it in 30 minutes from Mabopane to Pretoria because of traffic. So the planning must include you waking up much, much earlier. You know you're using a taxi, but you want to pretend as if the taxi is yours. You see? Yeah. But I mean, some of these things we know. It's not like you're going to wake up and take the key and you still have to wait, you know? And this taxi might come full and then it passes you, there's another taxi. So you always have to plan and think. You need to leave 2-3 hours before time, but we normally don't do that. So, just to demonstrate the point, some of you have done this before, and unfortunately, I don't want you guys to participate. You just have to sit like that and look as cute as you are and don't do anything. Those of you who have not done this before, I want you to take out a piece of paper and draw a house. Yeah. The whole idea was to be done in 10 minutes, and the budget is 1,000. Normally I do this in groups. I didn't do groups because of it's a small group and because of time. All right? And the assumptions is that suppose if you had a contract or a tender, you guys know the word tender, not a contract. Ne? I know you're more familiar with the tender. So you had a tender and you're using a couple of people to actually come up with this plan of a house. So I was saying that now, these people that you're paying them 10 rands per minute, that is the assumption that we have there. And the variable costs would be all the costs that you incur in the process of drawing the house were 20 bucks per minute. And if you had an office, you had a fixed cost of 20 bucks per minute. So now, if you're one person and you did the house in 10 minutes, so it means that, excuse me, for your direct labor, you paid 100 bucks because it's 10 by 10. Ne? And your variable cost, you pay 200 and your fixed cost is 200. So in all, you spend 500 bucks to do the house in 10 minutes, am I right? Right, now let's work on that assumption. And what if I told you that the house that I'm looking for is that house? What do you say to that? The gentleman who threw a church, what do you feel about that? Huh? The one who drew a human being. What do you feel about that? So the point, no, it doesn't look like yours. Yours needs to be plastered. There's a whole lot of things missing. It's almost like yours. And it's, no. The only thing is that yours has an upstairs, but this one just has a lot of things, this one. get the room. It's not a house. Those are rooms. So the whole idea is, in most cases, and that is why I call it our approach, is that when we approach our projects, we tend to jump in. We don't give it time to think about it and say, what is it that I'm expected to do? Now, I always use the example of a house and other things because I know that people know a house. So if I say a house, you're not going to ask me, what do you need from this house? Do you need a plan like what you did? Or do you need your north elevation or a plan? Or I mean, what's this? A floor plan or the whole outlook and the facade of the house? People don't ask those questions. They normally jump in because they know a house. And reality is, when you approach your project in research, you always need to understand, what is it that I need to do? And I always say this because in most cases, when we choose our research topics, we always choose in areas of where we're working or things that we normally do. So if it's something that you do, you always think that you know what you're supposed to be doing, or you always think that you know what the outcome should look like. All right? At a later stage, you get banned. Because either you go back to your supervisor and your supervisor says, no, this is not what you're supposed to do. And you say it's poor supervision. All right? And or sometimes you submit and what you have actually written to say that is what we're going to do and what you have submitted are two different things. Okay. When I was doing my MBA, there was a guy who, his supervisor, I think, went to India or something like that for 6 months. And he decided to proceed with his research. And the supervisor said, look, you can email me and so forth. And he felt that the supervisor was going to waste time. So he decided to do a questionnaire on his own. And the research was being done. I think he was working at ABI or something, one of these logistics companies. And he got permissions and he went ahead and interviewed people and he got feedback and he had like whatever number of responses. And when he submitted this for analysis, the statistician said, but your questionnaire does not talk to what you want to do. It's completely off, completely. We can't even salvage it. There's nothing to salvage. The whole thing must just be thrown out. And then it took him 6 months to run around and do that. And remember, in MBA, you do a mini dissertation, which you're supposed to finish in 6 months. So in this instance, it took him 6 months to do the wrong thing. Now, in 6 months, when he thought he was done, he had to now restart from scratch with a tool and then do a proper thing. And remember, then it's going to take you about 3 months to recover. It's not like when they tell you today, tomorrow you'll have the tool. You won't have the tool tomorrow because it's not like you go and buy it. It's not a span, and you don't buy it at Builder's Warehouse. You still need to sit down and cry, and it takes you about a week to cry, and then next week you cry some more. Then after 2 weeks, then you start when you start working, and then you start consulting. And then you get feedback, and in 3 months or 2 months, that's when you get a proper tool. Then you go back to the people who collected data from, and they say, ah, Mara, we've done this before. When our tweenya, man, we have done this thing before. We don't have time for you. You see? So that's unfortunate, and that's why I'm saying, and I highlighted this whole thing about our approach, because in most cases, our approach involves little or no planning. As I said earlier on, the only planning that we normally do in research is when you do your proposal. We don't sit and do a project plan to do our research. Okay, and I said, the only plan that we do is when you comply with your research proposal, that's when you put it in your proposal. And there is little or no understanding of your deliverables. And at the end of the day, we have surprises like that. You know about that bridge in Cape Town?
In PE as well.
In PE as well. And I would argue that when they did the bridge, the intention was not to leave it like that. Couldn't have been the intention. No, it couldn't have been. Because you have two bridges in Cape Town. They are misaligned. One is there, the other one is here. They're supposed to join each other at some stage. It's taken a couple of years and they don't even know how they're going to join them. They left them like that. So, and I argue that it was not supposed to be like that, because there's nothing artistic about the bridge. You can't say it's art. That was the plan. Okay. That was just a surprise at the end of the day because of poor planning. And that,
You must put a ramp on the other side so you can come speed.
Go and try it. Have you been there? The other one is on the other side of the ICC. And then there's almost the ICC in between them. Then there's another one on this side.
Required speed.
You won't make it. You won't make it. The only thing that they actually now use it for, maybe that was the purpose, they put a camera there. Because now, as this ramp goes, it's almost like an off-ramp. Then there's a proper road going on the other side. So they normally stop there and wait for you. And the other day he was waiting for me, this guy, and he forgot to tell me that he's waiting for me. So our current approach now, this is what we do. How many of you have done your proposals? And you have this in your proposal, ne? You do. Month one, month two, month three, and all these things, and chapter one, chapter two, chapter three, that's all you do. And the only thing you are, chapter one, I'm gonna do 2 months. Month one, 2 months, two, then you drag that bar 2 months. Data collection. That's what we do. I mean, what is the basis of actually arriving at that? And the only thing that you consider is that this thing here must end in 2 years. Because you were told that your registration, you're registering for a master's, you're going to do it in 2 years. So because it's 2 years, you actually drag this bar so that you actually have 2 years out of them. That's the only thing that you do. Then you submit, isn't it? But when you implement, how many of you actually go back to this thing and implement according to this? Nada. You don't even remember on page what of your proposal is this thing. You don't, because you've submitted this thing for the sake of compliance. And in essence, this thing is supposed to be your project plan, which you're supposed to be using to implement. All right? So the whole idea of this workshop is to learn how to actually do this thing properly, number one, and then go back to it and then use it to implement so that we can then stay on track. And that is what I call the project management approach. Okay? Now, in a project management approach, the first thing that we need to understand is the scope. When I said draw a house, the first thing that we needed to understand is the scope in terms of that particular house, right? So that we don't have the animals that we've seen, the churches and all these things and the car in the house and all these other things that we've seen. And I don't know what you describe, what you draw as. But yours was better. There was something around here. Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah. You couldn't even see it. It was invincible ink. Then you need to take that particular scope and divide it. Because the scope is too big. It's too broad. You need to divide it into small manageable pieces. Once you have done that, you need to then start scheduling. In most cases, when you do that, this Gantt chart that we normally do, we jump into scheduling. And why do I say that? We start by saying chapter one, 2 months. That's scheduling. And then you simply take the chapters. If it's six chapters, you simply take the chapters. You have now divided your scope into the chapters. But in actual fact, there's more to chapter one than there's more to chapter two and chapter three and so forth. There's a whole lot of information and data that is required to actually come up with what is called chapter one. So you can't divide it. You can't divide your project into your chapter ones and you start by scheduling. So the scheduling, as you can see, is the third thing that we need to do. Then you need to identify critical activities. This is a step that I normally skip because not so critical itself, although it says that you identify critical activities. It is mainly critical in your normal constructions and your large complex projects. However, in your research, it's something that I can just tell you about it, but I'm not going to dwell too much on it. Then you allocate resources. Again, if you're actually going to be using resources or your project is resource intensive, then you will need to actually do this step. It's not really an issue, but you'll see it's something quite simple. Only then you do a budget and you implement and control. Okay. In most cases, when you start a project, people will ask you, how much will this cost? And you say, 100 bucks. And later on, you realize that you actually under budgeted. Okay, in most of the things that we do, we always take it like that. And people get excited by a million. So when you say, this thing will cost 2 million. If they say, it's fine, you have 2 million, then you get too excited. And that is why you see that most entrepreneurs, they start by buying a car first. Because they think the 2 million will be sufficient. Only then, when they can't deliver, then they stuck. Because they have a car, but not the road that they were supposed to build. Because of this whole thing. Because remember, in most cases, people start to undercut themselves because they want to win the tender. So we're going to use an example. And this example, it's something that I don't know about. It's something that I just picked up from the internet last time when I did this. It's the topic was the conservation of indigenous knowledge. And it was by that particular author, Marty something. I can't pronounce that. And for those of you who want to read further, there's the link. By the way, I'm going to be giving you this, and I think I've emailed you the slides, so you can actually share the slides with them. It's the same, might be different layout and there, but it's almost the same. I can always send you this one as well. So you can follow the link and then you'll find the whole study. So what I did, I just picked up the study because I wanted to demonstrate a point to say that you can actually apply this approach to any project. Now, this study aims to determine the extent of indigenous knowledge conservation at cultural villages in South Africa. That's what they said they're going to do. So don't ask me a lot of questions and complex questions. I was not there. I was only on the internet when I picked this thing up, all right? So if you need any questions, you can go back to that lady there, Marty something, and you can ask her a lot of questions. That's why I provided you the link. So the sub-problems, again, that coming from the study itself, they wanted to define indigenous knowledge in South Africa. They wanted to provide a classification of indigenous knowledge. They identify the use of indigenous knowledge at cultural villages. They wanted to distinguish between advantages, disadvantages, and threats, and blah, blah, blah. They wanted to conduct a census of cultural villages in South Africa. They wanted to evaluate the extent to which indigenous knowledge is used at the identified cultural villages. And lastly, they wanted to measure the extent of indigenous knowledge conservation at cultural villages. So those are the things that they wanted to do, right? Now, as we go through this, I'm going to be using this to demonstrate some of the issues that I'm talking about. Now, their research methodology, again, this is them, not me. They were going to do a literature review. Remember here, the difference is, this is not the literature review that they were doing as part of a proposal. They're doing this as part of their research, okay? Now, and that is the components that they're going to be doing in the literature review. They'll do a knowledge audit, where they'll do a census and they'll do personal interviews, then analyze and do a comparative study, okay? And then do a statistical tests. So this I picked up from their paper. Now, we go back to what I said. The first thing is to understand the scope. That was just the example that we're going to be applying. I just wanted to tell you about it briefly. So the scope involves, the first thing is to understand objectives. We normally talk about objectives in research, isn't it? So we know what objectives are. We also need to understand the duration. We know in most cases 2 years. The budget, if it applies to us, the deliverables, your milestones, your requirements of the project, your limits and exclusions, and your reviews. Starting with your objectives. Now, in this example, I just picked up this objective. There might be more, but they said they wanted to determine the extent of indigenous knowledge conservation at cultural villages in South Africa. Okay? Now, the duration, I assumed it's 2 years. So now I'm defining my scope, by the way. So I'm using that example to show you that this is how you need to define your scope. And I'll show you the critical elements that you normally miss. I know the objectives we'll normally cover. That is why I'm not focusing too much time on that. The duration, it's given to you. It's 2 years. I know you're going to do it in 4 years anyway. The budget is limited because I know you just confirmed to me that you have nothing to do with the Guptas and the aeroplane at Waterproof. So we made that assumption. Now this, your deliverables. This is one of the key things that I say is important in defining. What is it that you need to deliver? When you come back and say that I've done my research project, what do you put on the table? Okay. Now, in this instance, I used what they call their sub-problems as their deliverables. But the idea is you need to sit down. You can actually break down your objectives and say that from this objective, for me to say that I've achieved objective number one, what do I put on the table? Okay? And you define that. It is not something that might go into your proposal. I think it goes, I'm not too sure. But for me, I say whether it goes in the proposal or not, depending on the format that you're following, it is very, very, very critical. Because if you do not understand your deliverables, what are you going to deliver? So, for example, I said we need to draw a house. Okay? That is what we need to, that is our objective. Our objective is to draw a house. Né? But in terms of the deliverable, we need to break it down to say, what do you mean a house? Then I'm going to say to you now, for you to actually bring me a house, I need you to have done a floor plan. I need you to do the south elevation, which is the facade, and the north elevation. I need you to show me the plaques. I need you to show me where the windows are, and. Now, that is now breaking down that particular objective into deliverables, right? Now, one of the things that I used to do is I used to open up a lot of shops. So I dealt a lot with your landlords, very ruthless, by the way. So what they did is, before you can open a shop, you need to present a plan. Okay. Now, because they actually don't take you through this process of saying, this is what we require when you say a floor plan, you'll find that in the first two or three shops that we did, I had to go back and, up and down, trying to meet their requirements. Because in terms of the plan, they want to see exactly where the lights will be, where the switch will be, if there's any plumbing, and. You understand? So that is your deliverable. Because remember, in my view, a plan, they said, we want a floor plan. In my view, a floor plan was simply to say, here's a room, here's the reception, and here's the kitchen. And that's it. They didn't want light. So you need to go into detail. So that is what I would call it's a deliverable. So we know the objective, but we need to know what is it that we need to deliver. So that when we meet the requirements, then they would say to us that we also need to deliver, to show in our plan the branding, the dimensions, and so forth. Okay. So where I'm standing is this is very, very critical. And it's something that you also need to sit with your supervisor and understand, because you need to make sure that as you embark on this thing, you all have the same understanding. Because there's nothing as frustrating as you coming back with what you think are your deliverables, the supervisor says something else, because you did not sit and then synchronize or align your deliverables. Okay. Yes.
What about if you are given two supervisors and one in the court, and both of them are not agreeing with each other? What do you do?
Yeah, it is a problem.
Because there are two and they are your supervisor. That one said, is it right what you do? The other one said, no, align it. Okay, when you try to ask, what do you mean by alignment? And you try to explain, you start to realize, you're changing my school. I was not going that direction.
Actually,
this one was right. But the problem is one. The other supervisor
doesn't,
is not on the same institution. And then what do you do?
Who's your main supervisor? That's the one you listen to.
Or it doesn't matter.
Remember, the core supervisor, the way I understand it, and I stand to be corrected, but my understanding is that the core supervisor is assisting the main supervisor. So the main supervisor is the one that is actually now supervising you with the assistance of this one. So the problem is, if you don't manage it like that, you find that you are going to be the grass that suffers when the two elephants are now fighting. So you need to choose your elephant.
So that is what I'm saying. When you have a situation like that, you are fine with your main supervisor. And you can see that they're not in line with each other. What do you do?
Main supervisor. I actually had the same challenge, and I resolved to follow the main supervisor, because I had a supervisor on campus and I had a co-supervisor who was elsewhere, and they were always arguing, and then you have issues. Whether it's
it is better when you have a main supervisor at campus. How is vice versa? Main supervisor somewhere else.
Yeah, but I think, look, at the end of the day, I think the main supervisor, but it's something that you can clarify with the university. But
I had the very same situation some months ago. What I did then, I spoke to my main supervisor, because the one who caused the shot. Every single time we speak about this, the co-supervisor says something else. You guys can align. So please give me direction. And then he gave me direction.
Yeah, that's why I'm saying that main supervisor, and I would actually even follow that advice to say that speak to your main supervisor, so that at least he can help you to manage the situation. It becomes very ugly. Yeah. In fact, it's something that I cover later on here. I think we'll then focus on it then as well, because it's something that I do emphasize at a later stage in terms of your reviews. And I think you have a point, because we need to clarify who's going to be the main supervisor, or who are you going to listen to going forward. So the deliverables, I think we're understanding each other. Okay. Now, the next one is milestones. These are not really that important. Milestones are just there to measure yourself, to see how far did I go. Okay, you wanted to achieve this and that by this time, and I just want to actually put those milestones so that at any given time I can see how far am I. Okay, it's more like your progress report. So you just need to give yourself a mark to see that when I get to this stage, I'm going to actually report myself or look at how far am I from my a milestone. The technical requirements of the project. Now this thing here can be very important depending on the type of project that you do, might not be important in certain projects. Okay. Now, I gave this example and I'm gonna give it to you again. I attempted master's in optometry at some stage. And I say attempt because I had different things that caused me to leave this project completely. So, one of the things is, by the way, that's where I had two supervisors, but eventually I went with the main supervisor. The project is that we were supposed to do a visual acuity chart in Zulu. So a visual acuity chart, for those of you who do not know, when you go to the optometrist, that is the chart that you read. Put it against the wall, you have your ABCs and all these things, and then you read that chart, okay? And the chart is designed to measure what is called your visual acuity. How far can you see at a particular distance? Okay, that is what the chart is designed to do. So that when we know how far you can see, we know the type of lenses that you require. And in some instances, we can be able to estimate the strength of the lenses that you require. We also know the condition that you actually are having, whether you are short-sighted or long-sighted or things like that, all right? So, but that information is critical. So we sit with my supervisor. I get, we think we're clever. We're at UKZN, by the way, but we're academics, you know? They call us lecturers. Eh? Some call you sir. So when you walk, you know, you're clever, you're sir. So we sit and we say, no, we need to design this thing in Zulu, because not everyone can read English. And we convince each other with the supervisor, with prof, and we say, ah, prof, this is a good idea, let's go for it. And we start. Prof, remember, prof has done a similar project when he was still in Saudi Arabia, when he did this chart in Arabic. So prof is giving me guidance and, you know, I'm going for it. That's my master's project. So I start doing literature review and blah, blah, blah. And we go through the whole motions. And a couple of months later, because remember, I still have other things to do. And I was not under pressure because I was not even paying for this thing myself. So I was doing it once in a while and I didn't have a project plan. So anyway, started this thing in Jan or Feb, I think. And sometime in June, July, we're sitting with prof. And in fact, I went to prof and I said, prof, this thing here is pointless. There's no need for us to do this thing in Zulu. Can you guess why?
The alphabet is the same.
The alphabet is the same. It's a Z, it's a Z, it's a Z. It's an A, it's, well, the only difference is that how do we pronounce that? You understand? If it's an A, some people will call it an A, some people will call it R, or whatever the case may be. And remember, we never use weights, we use alphabets. Once you put weights, you are no longer measuring how far that person can see. You are measuring how far that person can recognize certain weights. Because if you put certain weights together, and the person can see the first and the last letter, chances are they will recognize the weight. So they might not necessarily see the weight, but they can see the first and the last letter, a few letters in the weight, and they'll be able to put it together. So you did not measure how far that person can see, all right? Which is one of the reasons why the chart is never designed ABC, because they never want you to flow. It will always have these random ways that do not make sense. And certain weights, I mean, certain alphabets are excluded from the chart. So that whole thing, which is basically a technicality, we omitted. Because we never had an opportunity, or we never gave ourselves an opportunity to sit down and then really analyze and understand the technical requirements of this project that I was supposed to be doing. You understand? So you can imagine, after 6 months, I was frustrated because I can't do this thing anymore. You see, and Prof said, ah, no, let's find another topic to do. That's when I said, ah, yeah. I'm leaving this thing. Okay. Because then he said, we must change the topic. And I didn't want to change the topic. I actually didn't even want to be a master of optometry anymore. All right, and then I decided to do something else. But it can be very frustrating, especially when you pick something like that up after 6 or 7 months, when you've been working on this thing. Yes, I acknowledge I was not really intensively working on it, but the bottom line is that I was working on it. So even though I was working on it once a week, the reality is I wasted my time during those weeks when I was actually working at this thing, and it's really frustrating. And then see what it did to me. It led to me even leaving the entire thing completely. You understand? That was a frustration. So that is a technicality. In this particular one, I just picked up what they thought. I thought were technicalities. I might be wrong, but they said you need to do direct observation, you need to do it yourself, activities profile, and so forth and so forth. But I think the example that I gave really explains what I mean when I say the technical requirements of the project you need to understand. Again, this might not be something that goes into a proposal, but it's something that you need to do yourself. By the way, colleagues, everything that we're going to be discussing, I'm not discussing things that go into your proposal. I'm discussing things that you need to sit on your own and do on your table. All right, once you have done, you go to your supervisor and then just understand that we're on the same page. Am I right to understand this and that and that and that? Or this is my understanding of what I'm trying to do. This is my understanding of my deliverable, so that we can tick the boxes. So when you start working, you know for sure that you're working from, you're singing from the same hymn. All right? Limits and exclusions, I think everyone knows limits and exclusions. All right? What is it that we're not doing? What is limited? When I did the MBA, I was told to not try to solve the world's problems. Choose one problem, solve that. Other people will solve other problems. So that is why you need to have limits and exclusions, because in most cases, we tend to be carried away. When you start doing certain things and you find this and you want to come up with a solution, you want to come up with a solution, before you know it, you have about 4, 5, 6 things that you need to do, and it becomes too complex. You can't even manage it. So certain things you need to exclude. All right? So this is where you define the parameters of this. Now, the next important thing is the issue of reviews, which is what we spoke about. Discussion on the scope. So we need to understand and we need to agree, how are we going to make changes to the project? That's the first thing. And then in your instance, the issues with the main supervisor and the co-supervisor. Okay. And your authorizations and all that. But the idea here is that, and I felt it was important, because when I was at UKZ and my supervisor was on the corridor, so from time to time, I think when he was tired or whatever, he would call me, Mr. Kobe, please come to my office when you're less busy. And then when I go to his office, then we just discuss. In my view, just be a discussion. We sit, it just discusses the topic and this and that and that and that, and he would suggest changes. And I go back and I don't do the changes, he gets upset to say that you didn't do the changes that we discussed. All right? Then the next time I meet him in the corridor or wherever, he makes certain changes as well. Then I go back and I do the changes. Then he doesn't remember giving me those changes. Then he'll say, Maro, what is this? No, but Prof, you said I must do this, and you remember we met cafeteria, eh? I don't remember. So at some stage, we needed to agree to say, but Prof, when do I make these changes? Okay, now, when I did the MBA then, I had a different supervisor. What he said, we met once a month. Okay? When we meet, you come with chapter one. And he's going to take chapter one, he's going to mark chapter one. And we discuss whatever changes, I mean, challenges that you have or preparation for chapter two. When we meet the next month, he gives you chapter one. No. He was going to give you chapter one, I think, 2 weeks after you give it to him. He gives it to you. He said to us, I'm going to give it to you in hard copy, red pen. Okay? You address the red pen. We meet 2 weeks later, which would be a month from the first meeting. You give him chapter two. And then we discuss whatever we need to discuss. Then 2 weeks later, he gives you chapter two, red pen. You never go back to chapter one. You never go back to chapter two. We meet again, chapter three. Just like that. When you are done with all the chapters, You take everything, you give it to him in the last meeting. Changes, red pen. You address the red pen, you submit. Final, this is the final draft for submission. And that is how I managed to do my mini dissertation in 6 months. Because of that understanding. Because in most cases, if you don't have that understanding, you're going to give chapter one, make changes. You make changes, you submit chapter one. He scratches the changes that you said you must do. He goes back to the initial chapter one that you submitted. And you now change to the initial chapter one. You give it to him. He changes to the previous changes that he made. And then before you know it, it's 3 months. You're stuck on chapter one. Okay. That is the first scenario. The second thing that might happen is that you submit chapter one, first week, second week, third week, fourth week, fifth week, he's not responding. You follow up. You are afraid to follow up. And I mean, because you followed up once, ne? He didn't say anything. Then you don't know if you follow up the second time, are you pestering him or what? You're sitting like this on your laptop now. You don't know, do I type to this man or what? You know? Do I WhatsApp him? Hey, do I call? What do I do? Do I knock and say, by the way, Prof, I was just saying hi. By the way, how far are we there? You don't know how to approach it. The challenge is you did not sit and agree. Prof or Mr. Supervisor or Mrs. Supervisor or Miss Supervisor, when I give you this, when can I expect feedback? Okay. So that when you don't get feedback, you follow up. And your follow up, you can actually politely say, as agreed, I'm following up on this thing because it has been 2 weeks. All right? Because you agreed on 2 weeks. And after that, you can also agree, because sometimes it's nice to agree when you're still having fun and you're still meeting. And it's like when you meet a new lady, you know? In most cases, we tend to be too excited, we don't discuss certain things, ne? Then later on, we start fighting because of expectations. I get, you come home at 10. Yeah, now she was expecting you to be home at 2 in the afternoon because it's Saturday. Then when you come in home at 10, you are singing. Yeah. Right? Because you've been from wherever. And she's upset. And you don't understand why she's upset because you never sat down and agreed. Right? The same thing. And I always emphasize this because in most cases, I'll tell you, what is going to frustrate you is your own expectations of what the supervisor should do. Not that the supervisor did. Your expectations of what the supervisor should be doing. What will frustrate the supervisor is her or his expectations of what you should be doing. But both of you never sat down and discussed these expectations. Okay, because he's expecting to say that you should have finished chapter one by now. What is taking so long? But what he doesn't know is that where now you just got promoted at work, you're now dealing with a very complex project. You only have 1 day a week to deal with this thing. So all the other students that he supervised before will take a month, yes, but in this instance, you're going to take 2 months because of your challenges at work. All right, vice versa. What you also don't know is that this supervisor is supervising 9 other students. When you submit, he has this, all these things that he needs to go through, and you're expecting that when you submit, he's going to stop everything that he's doing and start attending to. You see, that's the problem. And then what causes that problem? Communications and your expectations. Mm-hmm. You understand? You agree?
Okay.
You're taking off your cap. You want to disagree?
No.
Okay, all right. You agree, ne? Yeah, no, it's true. Even in relationships, we always fight because of expectations. I always argue. If you really sit down and analyze, there's nothing else we fight about. It's your own expectations of what I should have done. And my own expectations of what you should have done. When I come home and I don't find food, and you should have cooked. And when you don't know, I expected you to cook. Then we start fighting. You see, that's the thing. So reviews, we need to talk. Especially talking when we just met, we're about to start this particular project, let's sit down and talk. It is not too late. You can still go back now and then engage your supervisor and make sure that we have the same understanding on most of these issues that we've just discussed now. All right, that's part of your plan. Because then you can then plan knowing for sure that when I submit this, I'm going to get it in 2 weeks or in 2 months. If I don't get it, this is the reason. And also, how do I submit it? Do I email it? Do I print out a copy? How do I get corrections? Because again, as I said, you want to avoid verbal corrections as much as possible. Okay, you want to avoid verbal corrections as much as possible. Let it be in writing, whether it's email or in red pen or whatever the case may be, so that you can always go back and say, no, but this is what you said I must do. Because it will be very frustrating, I can tell you, to write something and they say change it, and later on you go back to what you wrote. And when you compare, it's exactly what you wrote before, and they said you must change it. Now, once you have done, that is your scope. So once you have done that, you now understand what it is that you need to do. You now understand your deliverables, you understand your reviews, you understand your objectives, you understand your technical requirements, all these things. Then you can start sitting down and say, right, now I need to break down the scope into small manageable pieces. All right? So, this we call the work breakdown structure. In my view, this is your backbone of your project plan. If you don't do this, the whole plan is useless. You can't manage it. You need to break it down, because once you've broken it down, excuse me, it's easy to develop a baseline plan. And you can group work activities together. Now, let me ask you a question. I want to use the example that I used previously, Mara. These familiar faces are making life very difficult for me. Maybe I should take off my glasses, that way I don't see you, and then I can just ask the question. You see, then I don't know who's who in the zoo. Marawena can still see. They're too close. Okay, so we're going to Cape Town. And from Cape Town, you're going to Durban. And from Durban, you're coming back here. How long will it take you? Cape Town, Durban, here. How long? Yeah, you're driving. You're shaking your head?
Am I staying in like Cape Town, Durban?
And drive.
Yes.
No, okay.
No, you can sleep or whatever. You tell me. Now I'm asking you, how long will it take you?
2 days.
2 days, ne? Okay.
I will take 2 days.
2 days? You're not going to Cape Town. No, go to Cape Town.
So I have to drive.
Yeah. You want to ask which car?
No.
Okay.
Off the time frame.
Okay, it's fine. What are you thinking? Tell me.
I need to know why I'm going. Why?
No, you're just going.
Just going.
It's a road trip. I want a black people. Can't even do a road trip.
Eh? I feel like I don't have enough information.
You don't want to go to Cape Town?
I don't have enough.
You're doing a road trip.
Yeah, it's a road trip.
Road trip to Cape Town and come back. You only want to drive where you have relatives, Chief.
For a funeral.
Okay, go to Cape Town then. An estimation, how long will it take you? 2 days. 5 days.
2 days,
ne? You're still not sure if you're going to Cape Town or not. Okay, your uncle died, so you need to pick him up and take him to Durban because he used to live there, so you know how it is again. Then you're going to bury him here. Now, can you go to Cape Town, please?
Okay, context. I need to know what I'm using to get there.
You're using a car.
Like what car though?
Which car do you want to use?
Ferrari.
Which car do you want to use? Okay. This man is not going to Cape Town. No, this man. See, chances are he has never been to Cape Town. Or he made a mess in Cape Town, this man. Who do you owe in Cape Town? I've never seen a man afraid to go to Cape Town like this. Hypothetically speaking, he's not physically going to Cape Town, but you can see the man is frightened. Cape Town! Okay, let's leave you, Chief.
Yeah.
You're not going to Cape Town? When I will go to Hartlepool? So, 2 days and I have 5 days. Ne? Now, what I wanted to demonstrate there is that in most cases, that's how we plan. We look at something, we just thumbsuck, and we came up with 2 days. But the reality is, if you really want to know how long it will take, you need to break the trip down. Mm-hmm. All right? From here to Bloemfontein, as an example, I know for sure it will take me 5 hours. Okay, if you're driving one of those, what are you driving, by the way, Tata to Hartebeest? No, he was worried about which car you're driving, Mercedes-Benz or whatever, but you know, you can estimate to say from here to Bloem. If you can't estimate Bloemfontein, let estimate, Kroonstad. From Kroonstad, then I'm going to rest, as you asked. I'm going to rest, I'm going to take 15 minutes, and I'm going to be on the road again for another hour. I'm going to get to Bloemfontein, I'm going to rest, I'm going to do this, and so forth, up until you get to Cape Town. So if you add all of them together, you'll now know to say that it's going to take me 2 days or 3 days to get to Cape Town and go to Durban and come back. But in most cases, we don't do that. And I'm one of the culprits who didn't do that in 2014.
Yeah.
No, 2013. Yeah? One of the two. So we went to Cape Town, myself and my friend with our wives. All right? And you know how wives are. When are you know? I can see you married. In the same WhatsApp group, me and you. So they don't want to drive for some strange reason. But now they can't drive. Hmm? No. They don't even want to be in the car. Why not? They want to fly to Cape Town. Exactly. That's what I mean. For some strange reason, she says it makes sense. You see what I mean? So they want to fly to Cape Town. They're not driving to Cape Town. And if you want to go to Cape Town with them, we better make sure that they're flying. Irrespective of the costs of flying and all of four of us flying and then booking a car in Cape Town and so forth. But nevertheless, now we need to go to Cape Town. And you've already declared that there's a trip to Cape Town. So you can't leave them. Because then they're gonna ask you, who are you going with? You see, Marwana, they didn't want to go. I mean, then you must give an option to go with someone who's willing to drive to Cape Town. But in any way, that's a debate for another day. So eventually we book a flight for them. For the two of them, we drive. And I was in charge of the logistics. And I look at this thing from here to Cape Town, 1,500 kilometers. I'm driving this car. I'm going to floor it. I'll be in Cape Town in about 12 hours. So I book a flight for them for 4 o'clock. It lands in Cape Town at 6. We leave at 6 in the morning because if it's 12 hours, according to me, when they land, I'll be parking in Cape Town. That was me. That was my planning. It makes sense. Go and divide. You'll see. If you take 1,500 and you're doing 140 kilometers per hour, you'll see. That's, you see, I use the calculator. It gave me 12 hours.
That was your planning, right?
That was my planning, yeah. So anyway, we go to Cape Town now. And around halfway through, they call. They say, no, they're going to the airport. All right? And when I look at the distance, I think we're still 800 kilometers away from Cape Town. But now they're at the airport, they are about to board this flight. So meaning it's around 3 o'clock. Then I start pressing.
6 hours to move.
Yeah. Later on, I still see this board saying 800. So this thing is following me. This board, I passed it and left it. Went and waited for me, Kopile. Said, Cape Town, 800 kilometers. And now I'm pushing. Now, 4 o'clock, my wife calls me. No, they are leaving. Now I'm 500 and something kilometers away from Cape Town. Now I'm panicking now. I'm pushing this thing. And then, you know, as you approach Cape Town, then the road becomes very windy. I'm trying my best. 160 and above. I don't want to mention it because I'm on camera. So I'm pushing. 6 o'clock, they land. I'm 200 and something k's away from Cape Town. Then the question, you know that question, eh? Where are you? And you know the answer, again. I'm coming. But I was not lying again. I was coming, isn't it? Yeah, I was going. No, I'm coming. They say, no, where? I said, no, I'm in the car. I'm coming to Cape Town. They say, how long? I said, no, I'm coming. I'll be there just now. Yeah, just now. So now I start pushing, and you can imagine now we are in trouble. So we say, no, in the meantime, you can take a cab and go to the hotel. They say, no. Waiting for you here. How far? Now, how far is very specific. Then you don't want to give a specific answer. You can't give kilometers now. You say, not far. You see, nevertheless, we arrived at Cape Town at 8 o'clock. So it was 14 hours. And you can imagine or now. People are upset now, you know. And we had to now make it up for them. So the whole idea is, when I did my planning, I forgot to take into account the stops. Because I needed to refuel this thing. Yeah? We needed to eat. And over and above that, there were stop and goes. Then there are trucks on the road and all these things. And I just took it and said 1,500 divided by this speed, I should be in Cape Town in 12 hours. But if I'd broken down and I said, no, from here to here, then we're probably going to stop for about 20, 30 minutes. And then we'll do this. I would have actually seen that even the 14 hours, I really pushed it. Because ideally, I was supposed to give myself about 16 or 17 hours just to make sure that I can drive, relax, and stop, and stretch your legs. And so because at some stage, it became a race now. We couldn't walk to the toilet. You had to run. <'Cause> now, working on time. Well, and when you refuel, you say to the guy, put 100 bucks. You can't fill this thing. Just 100. We just need to get to where we're going. We'll fill it up in Cape Town. So it was a race. So that was the mistake that we made. So the whole idea is now, if you don't take something like that and break it down, it's like taking this project that is huge. You're supposed to finish in 2 years, and you don't break it down, and you think you're going to manage it. You can't. It's exactly the same as what I did. So you need to break it down into small, manageable pieces. What is the work breakdown structure does? Now, if you take a car, you're building a car. The car will have a body, a mechanical, and electrical. Am I right? It's a simple car, by the way. Don't blame me and say, why the electronics? It's a simple car from point A to point B. You have a panel, you have a chassis. I've never built a car before, so I just made assumptions. Mechanical will be made up of engine and a steering. Electrical will be ignition and lights. And then you have all these other things that you write, I've put them as activities right at the bottom. Now, if you were to take row number 1, 2, 3, 4, the last one, the one written activities, if you only focus on that and do only those things, would you not have a car? You would, isn't it? Now, the idea is when you now break down your work or your scope into small manageable pieces, you need to break it down to that. In most cases, we tend to break it down to what we call a work package, which is that. So the first one is a project level. The second one is a work package. Now, why do I say a work package? Take, for example, chapter 3, where you collect data. Chapter 4. There are so many aspects to chapter 4. Am I right? In terms of data collection. But in most cases, when we plan on chapter 4. So now you have actually planned on work package. You have not taken chapter 4 and broken it down into small manageable pieces. Because let's say you're collecting data physically. So when I say physically, you're going to be doing administering questionnaires or you're doing interviews. You're going to go to this person and that person and that person and that person. Let's say there's 20 people that you need to interview. In my view, those are 20 activities. Because when you break it down, you will now see that you're not going to be able to complete chapter 4 in 1 month. Because in that particular month, you only have 1 day per week. Remember, you work. Some of you have other activities that you're doing. On Saturday, people are going to die. You need to be at the funeral. And we know how it is. Ne? You're not going to do anything on Saturday. Chances are you have Sunday. And Sunday, you're going to church and so forth. So reality is you might actually work on this thing during the week. And because you're working, you're going to ask your supervisor for 1 day per week. So in that particular 1 day per week, the person that you're interviewing is in Johannesburg Central. There's traffic, you're from here. You need to drive to Johannesburg Central. Chances are you're going to interview only that one person only. So you have 20. Well, now you've put the whole chapter 4 as 1 month. But reality is, if you now stick to that schedule, you're going to interview only 4 people in that month. Can you see that? But you didn't break it down. You're only working it as chapter 4. Now, guess what happens at the end of the month? If you look at this thing, at the end of the month, you're supposed to be done with chapter 4. You know when you're done with chapter 4, you get frustrated. You're now working, there's a delay now. you start getting very, very frustrated. However, if you've broken it down, you would actually see that I'm still on time. So I argue that when you do this thing, you need to work at activity level, not work package level. It's still too broad to manage. So you need to break things down to activities. Excuse me. An activity is one item. Make it an action so that you can see it's one item. Because if it's an action, the minute you put end, it's two items. Right. So I'm going to interview this gentleman. That's one item. And it's an action. And it's specific. That's an activity. You put it there. That's now your plan. Because that plan, you can be able to estimate your time and the resources that you need. If you put so many items, you still back to, you have just simply taken your package, you just described it. You have not broken it down, you just put a description to it. All right, so you need to make it one item, which is an activity. Now, let's take an example. The example that we had, they had the conservation of IK, that was the project. Now they said, remember, in their collection methodology, they were going to do literature review, knowledge audit, and an analysis. Right? Those, according to me, are still packages. Because under that, they said, sure, I don't know if you can see that. Okay, you still can. So they said, under literature review, they're going to do classification of IK. In my view, that classification is one item. It's an action item. You classify indigenous knowledge, and you do that. Whether you sit in the library or whatever, you do that, it's that. You identify the cultural villages. There's one here, there's one there, there's one there. You also get their contact information if needs be. And then you do identify advantages, disadvantages, and so forth. Then you go to the next package, and they said they're going to do a census, employee interviews, and visitor interviews. And now if you look at what I've done, I said a census is still a package, because under the census, they're going to do interviews, telephonic interviews. So in this instance, because there are different cultural villages, I then took one cultural village to say, now when they pick up the phone and call this cultural village called Shakaland, it's one activity, it's one item. Now why do I do it like that? Because then you can estimate to say that for me to pick up the phone and my questionnaire is 10 minutes, and I'm going to say, how are you? Can I speak to so and so? I'm going to give it roughly 15 minutes to do this interview. In 15 minutes, I hang up the phone. Okay? Then I know for sure that if I have about 3 hours, in 3 hours, I can do this number of interviews. Then you can't tell me that is not a better way to plan, because then with that, you have now taken into account your own schedule. Because we tend to have these week ones and week sevens and whatever the case may be. But we forget that in those particular weeks, we have responsibilities at work, at home, and everywhere else, at church. When someone dies, you know how it is. You need to go. If you don't go, then it's going to be a whole hoo-ha. Then there's a wedding. They invite you. We have all those responsibilities over and above doing our research. So the whole idea here is you need to break it down so that you can, first of all, look into your own schedule. Secondly, make it small manageable pieces, because you can be able to steal 2 hours on your day, 3 hours on this day and that. Because if you leave it as a week, in your mind, you need to clear a week. But if you know for sure that, look, my activities are planned such that I need 30 minutes or this, then I can actually go to my day. I know for sure that on most days, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm not doing much. If you're working in government, we know from 12 o'clock, you're not doing much anyway. So we know from 12:30, I can start working on this thing. Okay, no, sorry, 12:30, I know government, they go to lunch. They come back at 3. So from 3 o'clock to 4 o'clock, I actually say I have an hour where I can use government resources. I guess the only reason they come back is to use the resources. So I have an hour where I can use these government resources and then do what I need to do. Okay, so you now take out this whole notion from your mind to say that you need to clear a day, because you've broken down this thing. You have now taken your schedule. You can actually see exactly when I'm going to, where am I going to slot it in. So that is why you'll see that I recommend to say that when you look at a project like this, break it down into one action item, let it be an action item, and let it be specific. There's nothing wrong as having 10 items or whatever, because the 10 items, then you can be able to go back and see when am I going to do those particular items. So if you look at what I've done here, is I have my work breakdown structure for this particular project. And the blue are the packages. And that, what color is that? The ladies?
Orange.
Okay, today it's orange. Né? You know how it is with ladies. They can tell you it's deep red, baby orange, what, mandigo, and they always have these colors that we don't know. I mean, how do you know Plunk has so many shades? There's baby blue or dark blue or what blue, and pink, powder blue, you see, and you see, blue is blue. Sky blue, then pink, there's baby pink and what pink, and I've never heard of adult pink. Why is there baby pink but there's no adult pink?
Huh? That's
dusty pink. Hi. So
on the wedding invitations you get some color.
Rose gold.
Exactly, you see. So no. So I'm always afraid to mention the colors when I do this thing. So I always let the ladies guide me. So I'll accept today you said it's orange. Okay, so we'll go with orange for today. If you ask them tomorrow, by the way, the same color would have changed. So the orange are your activities. And the idea, as I said, break it down into one action item. Now, I argue, if you miss this step, it's going to be very, very difficult for you to manage your project. All right? It's going to be very, very difficult to miss. So the whole notion of your chapter ones and all these things, break them down. What is involved in chapter one? Okay? So what I did, for example, I'm busy with my a DBA proposal. So in my chapter one, the way I did it, I've actually broken it down to say, what is it that I want to talk about in this thing? So I have outlined the whole this thing to say, I need to talk about this. Now all those things, I collect information can be on a daily basis. Let me just say on a weekly basis, I know that I'm going to collect information on this. So I call them themes when I sit alone. Because remember, when you're sitting alone, you can use any English word. There's no one who's going to tell you anything. Anything goes when you're alone. So when I sit alone and I write in my own notebook, which I don't show anyone else, I write themes. You don't want to show people what you write in your own notebook. Otherwise, they'll start correcting the English. My 12-year-old son corrects my English all the time. So I don't even tell him that these things are themes. I call them things for him. It's just things. Thing can be anything. So I have these themes that I actually work according to. So I collect my information in terms of that. And it allows me to break things down, because then I know that I've covered this theme. And I'm going to go to this theme. And I'm going to... So then I also can see progress when I sit, because then I don't get frustrated to say that, hey, I'm not moving. You understand? Because then most of the time, the challenge is now when you really need to start working and you actually cannot see traction. But now because I collect and I put them away, I know for sure that I actually now go and I tick. And I know that I've collected this, and I have this information, and I have this, and I have that. You see, so I've done this in terms of what I'm going to be working on going forward. So hence I say, for me, it's one of those things that is very, 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 extremely critical. Now, I'm told that lunch is going to be at 2:15. Half past two. Do you want to take a 5-minute break? Or, the way you said yes so fast. Okay. Let's do 5 minutes. It's now 20 minutes to 2. Let's come back at around 10 to 2. So let's make it 10 minutes. We go to the next section, which is now scheduling activities. So what we've done is we did a scope, which is trying to understand what is that we're doing. We broke it down into small manageable pieces. Now we need to schedule it. Okay. Now, this is the part where I said most of the time we jump to scheduling before we even understand the scope and all these other things. We start saying month one, month two, and all these things that we put on our in our so-called project plan. So this thing here is called the Gantt chart, right? And this is basically when you're scheduling activities into a list of, or basically it contains a list of sequences. It can contain your duration, it can contain your start and finish date, it can show your critical path, it can show your resources, it can show your cash flow. The idea with this is that when you have done it properly, you need to get to a stage where you can actually blow it up. Not blow as in like a bomb, ne? Blow as in like the size of paper and put it on the wall. And you walk in the morning or every week and you know exactly what is that you need to do on that particular day. Because you've done it properly, you need to now have your activities against your dates. Okay. Now, okay, this is an effective presentation of scheduling information, instruction accurately and precisely. One of the things that I want to emphasize here is when you do this thing, you don't do this month one, month two, month three. Stay away from this month one, month two, month three, month. As a belief. Why am I saying that? Because month one, as I said earlier on, you only have one day. If you realistically look at your own schedule, or 2 days. Now, when you simply say month one, you have overestimated or underestimated the time. The time you realize that you only have 1 day per week, you'll find that in that particular month, you only have 4 days. And if you go back to the example that I said earlier on to say that you need to collect data, and you're doing these interviews, and these people are all over the place, and you need to synchronize that time. Because remember, the fact that you have put it on a Tuesday doesn't mean that I'm available on a Tuesday, isn't it? I might be available on a Wednesday. And on a Wednesday, you're not available because you have responsibilities at work. So you need to start swapping things around, going to your supervisor or moving this meeting or do whatever the case may be to try and synchronize with me. By the time you actually now manage to do that activity, it's Friday. And then I say to you now, yes, I'm available, but I'm in Germiston. And you want to collect data from me. I'm not going to come to you in TUT, isn't it? You want to come to Germiston. And you need to drive to Germiston. And so half a day is gone. You see? You want to say something?
Yeah, no, I want.
Mm.
Sorry,
no problem.
I'm looking at it and I'm thinking that it was one of the things that prolonged my research as well was that it was that approval from the ethics committee.
Mm-hmm.
Because I submitted in April.
Mm.
And then the back and forth, and then I only got approved in October. So then how do you then come and measure that? Because you actually don't know when are you going to get
that. Yes, that approval, you'll see, it normally is something that we cover when you now create a buffer in your project plan. Because you need to create that buffer. Either you can create it in terms of critical activities. So critical activities means that if you have this activity number one, which you're doing in month one, I'll come back to the month one issue. You're doing in month number one. You have scheduled activity number two to start in month number two, right? But the way they are signed or the way they you have structured this thing is that activity number one must happen first, which is now the approval. Because you can't move to number two without the approval. So that means that activity number one is on the critical path because any delay on that particular activity will mean the entire project is delayed. All right. Now, when you do is that when you start looking at that, you need to identify which are your critical activities. And once you've seen the critical activities, you go to the non-critical activities and say, should the critical activity happen or should a delay happen? How am I going to move my non-critical activity so that I can still complete things on time? So it might mean that at some stage, for example, you'll see when we start working on it later on, you might need to employ more resources to try and do certain things parallel, which are not necessarily critical. Or you might need to delay some things that are not necessarily critical to make sure that everything that is now on a critical path is going to be done within the time that you have. Or alternatively, you might, as you design this thing, create a buffer to say, I know for sure that this thing will take me 1 day. Okay? However, I'm going to add an additional 5 days, just in case. So you find that your entire plan, you've actually now created these buffers, all right, up until your 2 years. Because the problem is, when we go at this approach of your month one, month two, month three, we don't create a buffer. We don't know which activities are critical, which ones are not. So you find that in some instances, when you actually had time, you do not even realize you had time and you wasted that particular time. But if you actually broke things down, you'll see that, no, you know what, I actually have time here. So I'm not going to actually plan this thing such that I have too much time here. I'm going to spread this time to say that every activity, even if it finishes this week, I'm going to put in my plan that it finishes 2 weeks later. so that I have these 2 weeks to play with. The next activity, I put another 2 weeks. The next activity, I put another 2 weeks. So at the end of the day, you know that, okay, this thing is going to take me 2 years, Mara, every time I have these 2 weeks in between to play with. So there's various ways to do it. The only problem is the way we've been doing this thing is we never really see what is supposed to happen when, so that when there's that delay, you can actually go back to your activities and say, how do I compensate for that 4 months? Because it is still possible. Okay, it is still very much possible because you know for sure that, okay, I have Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, I was going to do one activity on each and every day. I have a delay of 4 months. If I take these activities and I start doing two every day, I can recover 2 months or I can recover 3 months and things like that. All right. So hence I say, stay away from month one, month two. When you do this thing, I urge you, take out a calendar, put a calendar there, and then be realistic and practical. Work on a calendar. Because your month one or your week ones include Friday, tomorrow is a holiday. Are you going to do any work?
No.
You can't. Exactly. See? Saturday, you have a funeral to attend, especially it's a long weekend, something is happening or there's a wedding. You're not going to do any work. Sunday, you're going to go to church. You're going to come back to church, you're going to say, I'm relaxing. Okay, some of you are going to induce babalas deliberately. So that on Monday, you say, I'm babalast. But then the reality is now in that week, which you said was week one, you only have 4 days. And in the 4 days, you don't have 4 full days, isn't it? You have limited time in those 4 days, because in the 4 days, perhaps on Mondays, you know for sure, like for me, I know that I can't schedule anything on Monday. Mondays are hectic. And I know that Tuesday, I have a little bit of time. So realistically, I have Tuesday and perhaps maybe Wednesday in my week. So what I call a week is actually 2 days. All right. Now, when you consider all the other responsibilities, because even in that 2 days, you don't have 8 hours. We don't think about these things. We don't have 8 hours in those things. You have probably 4 hours. Because even if you assign 8 hours, if you're going to go to the library, you still need to travel. Then there is lunch. Then Joas is going to come and disturb you. You see, then you sit outside the library and you go back. Things like that. That is reality. The problem is when we plan, unfortunately, as I said earlier, on human nature, we tend to now divorce reality to the plan. And we come up with this plan that is ideal, but is not practical. You understand? Then when you implement the plan, the practical takes over. Okay? Because, I mean, you're sitting there, and I come and I disturb and I say, hey, how are you? And you start talking. We do a chitty chat. Before you know it, it's an hour. All right? You're not going to say, go away. Probably you're going to engage me. If you're sitting in your office, someone walks in your office, chances of you saying, look, go away are very slim. You can say it once in a while, but you won't be known to say, ah, this one. When you go to an office, she's, you understand? You're not going to do that. And you know how people are. If you lock your office, that's when they knock even harder. They knock because they know. Someone says, no, she's in there. Then you knock him. And then you say, no, I'm busy with my research. They say, yeah, but then have you seen the email by so-and-so? That's reality, colleagues. You see? So, hence I say, go back to your calendar. Look at your calendar. What is feasible? What is realistic in terms of your calendar? Again, look at the people that you actually now are involved in your research. There is no point having data collection on a Friday if you're going to be collecting from Muslims. They won't entertain you, I guess.
Yeah.
They won't at all. So you need to consider those things to say that this is the culture, this is this, this is that. Chances are I'm not going to get anyone there. We laugh about the whole issue about government, but we know for sure. Chances of you getting someone on a Friday afternoon in office and for them to really give you their time are very slim. In government, even in universities. Yeah, even in universities. Now where I work, on Fridays at 12 o'clock, it's like the whole building is on fire. People evacuate. They don't even go home. They evacuate. You know when you evacuate? They evacuate. You're not going to get anyone at 5 minutes past 12 to give you attention on this thing. Because there's this whole thing of saying, oh, Friday we go home early. I don't know for what. You see? So, at VUT. Yeah?
It's almost everywhere.
No, at VUT they put a schedule there. So people are supposed to swap, right? At, I work at Science Campus. So people are supposed to swap. So there's a certain group that will leave at 12, then another group might stay. But what I've seen is that the entire group lives at 12. So when I got there, I was still new. Like, I would used to stay and go and check the chat. Now I'm part of the entire group. So now I've actually been created my own group of not going on Friday. I'm in my own group now. There's no point. I mean, I stay in Kempton Park. I drive to VUT. It takes me an hour. I get to VUT at around 9, 9:30. Then I stay there. 12, I come back. No, I might as well. They'll find me at home. You see, but the reality is we need to consider those things. So if you're collecting data from me and you want to come and collect this data from me at VUT at Friday at 2 o'clock, you have another thing coming. And remember, if it, that is the day that you have planned to collect data every day, I mean every week, then it means you'll never be able to collect data from me at all. You see, so we need to consider those things. When I did my this MBA, I did my questionnaire was on Question Pro. So my response rate was low. So at some stage I decided to say, you know what, I'm gonna go physically to the people that were on this thing, and I'm gonna go and ask them on my sample, and I'm gonna go and ask them to complete that. So I went with the iPad and I was asking them to say, you know, can you please complete this thing? So I would open it up for them and give it to them and wait. So I drove to Port Chepstow. And I went to see this other guy and I asked him, can you please complete this? Oh, by the way, before I went, they said, no, he's busy. But eventually they said, no, you can come in. And he said, you can come in. I went in and I said, no, this is what I'm doing. And again, I'm asking you to please complete this. It was taking 7 minutes, by the way. And he says, no, I'm still busy. Wait for me. Okay, I said, yeah, but it'll just take 7 minutes of your time. He says, no, I'm still busy. But now he finishes what he's doing on the laptop. He sits back and he starts asking me questions. Now he's interviewing me. Why am I doing the MBA? Where am I from? Who am I? Who's my mother? Things like that. Do you understand? Now I'm asking all these questions. I guess I need him to complete. So I can't even say, why are you asking about all these things? I mean, I'm doing my MBA for my own reasons. How difficult is the MBA? Hey, I heard it's the divorce course. Are you still divorced? Are you still married? And so forth. An hour later, this man is asking me questions. He has not completed this thing. And I kept on saying, by the way, this thing is 7 minutes. Yeah, no, I'm still busy. So an hour later, it's 4 o'clock. Guess what? He says, no, 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 it's late. Come back tomorrow. Yes, I won't remember. I won't forget that guy. Where I meet him is going to be a serious misunderstanding, me and him. Serious misunderstanding. I guess I'm done with the MBA now, so I can do whatever I want to do. So in any event, I'm in Port Chepstow, by the way. And according to me, Port Chepstow is 100 kilometers away. According to me, I was doing in and out. I had a couple of other people that had agreed to complete this thing, except this guy who said I must come tomorrow. Now I have a decision to make. I go back home and come back tomorrow, so that is another 200 Ks. Or do I find a place to sleep? And how do I explain it to the madam now? Well, I remember I didn't apply for this visa in advance. Visa you don't apply for on the spot. It's not like one of these visas that you grant on arrival. You must apply for this visa in advance and explain. So in any event, I had to take my chances and do an emergency visa, which was approved. But you had to motivate. You know, you need to write a serious motivation to say, what happened in Pochester? Who did you meet? Why are you sleeping there? Who go? So you do an emergency visa. Hey, where are you sleeping exactly? With whom? What time are you going to sleep? Hey, do you have pajamas? Hey, what? You see? So you do an emergency visa, you do a full motivation, and you still need to defend the motivation, because after they read the motivation, they call you. What do you mean here? Hey, who's this? And this one? Why are you eating? And so forth. Who do you know in Port Chepstow? Let's see a list of people you know. Where are the females? So, an event, I had to sleep in Port Chepstow. And then go back. And that one was just unfortunate. I mean, there was nothing I could do about it. But I'm just saying that those are the realities of life when you actually collect it. Because the thing is, I could say, you know what, stuff you. But the thing is, I didn't know who else is going to agree to complete this. So at least this one has agreed. It's just a matter of getting him to spend 7 minutes of his precious time to complete this thing. So eventually the following day I went and I had to wait for him. And about an hour later, then I walked out. And he did the 7 minutes thing. And the day I got the MBA, I wanted to go back to him and say, nah. But I didn't do it. So, back to the gang chart. How you do the gang chart? If you go back to what we said were activities only, you can do your packages, it's fine, but don't focus on the packages. You can do the packages just simply for the sake of description and identifying which activities belong where. But what you need to focus on when you do your gang chart is your activities. All right? So you take your activities, you create a list of the activities. Now, if you look at the numbering on the side, it's just basically your numbering like you do your paragraph. If you look at, for example, this, just quickly go back. You'll see that on literature review, I have it as, okay, the whole project is 1.0.0.0. I said it's four numbers there because we have four layers. All right? So the literature review is 1.1.0.0. The next one there, because they are all under literature review, they will always start with 1.1. Can you see that? So that's the numbering. It's just simple as that. It's like your paragraphs. I don't need to focus on numberings unless if some of you must go back and get your refund on your school fees. Yeah, they wouldn't have taught you properly to do numbering. Description. That's when you take all the list of activities. So you take all the orange, all of them, and you create a list. All right? The next thing you have that is called what is called predecessors. That's when you actually now determine which activity must happen first. Now that is just you logically sitting down and saying, now I know for sure that this thing must get ethical clearance. All right? After ethical clearance, this will happen. Now, if you look at, for example, we said classification of IK. We're saying that this is going to happen first. And then they'll identify cultural villages. Now they said they're going to identify advantages, disadvantages, and threats, and blah, blah, blah. And then I said, perhaps they need to classify IK first and identify these cultural villages before they can do number three. Which is why you'll see that I say predecessor, I just wrote the numbers there. It's 1.1.0, which is classification of IK, and 1.1.2.0, which is the identifying cultural villages. Then I go down, I go to telephone in Shaka. So to call Shaka land, you need to have identified it first. Right, so that is just logical. So the predecessor there will be 1.1.2.0. So I do the entire thing just looking to say logically which one must follow which one. And there are certain things that don't have to follow each other. Then those ones you don't put a number. As you see, 1.1, the first one and the second one, there's no number after that on the predecessor. Meaning that those ones can happen at the same time. All right? Now, once we have done that predecessor, having determined which one must follow which, you can then look at the time. Normally in project management, they always use the three times, optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic time. All right? Now, there's a formula that they normally use. I excluded that particular formula because I said we don't need to use calculators here. But the formula, even if you follow it and you go to the project management tools and so forth, you'll see that it will always take you back to the most likely time. So if you do a proper estimation of your time, you'll always come back to the most likely time or close to the most likely time. Okay. Now, the only idea here is just to recognize that there are always three scenarios, your best case scenario, normal case scenario, worst case scenario. So you need to determine to say that based on the people that you're working with, am I going to be working on the worst case scenario? Comes back to what we discussed earlier on to say that do you give yourself that buffer or are you going to working on optimistic time? The unfortunate part is that we will normally work on optimistic time and it doesn't work out like that. Okay. And once you've done the most optimistic time, you find that in most cases or the majority of your project was on pessimistic time. So you need to decide to say, I'm working on government or I'm working at VUT. So chances of me getting this thing and the most optimistic time are unlikely. I'm not even going to work on most likely, I'm going to work on this. So I know this thing can take me one day, but however, I'm going to schedule 5 days. That's your decision, all right? But for you to do this, there's one thing that is extremely critical. For you to actually come up with this estimation of time, you need to have broken it down to one item. Because if you call Shaka land, you pick up the phone, you call Shaka land, you speak to this gentleman, you can't tell me you can't estimate how long it will take you. You know the question, All right, you can be able to estimate, to say that I know for sure in an hour this thing will be done. But if you say you're going to be calling Gauteng province and there are 20 offices there, will you be able to determine how long it will take you? You won't. You'll still be able to now, you still need to go back and say now 20 offices is going to take me 1 hour per office, and you did exactly the same thing. You see? And you're going to say 20 hours. And unfortunately, the current approach now, when you start determined to say there are 20 hours, we put it on the plan to say 20 hours. You don't have 20 hours in that month. You don't. Because you need to go back to your month and determine to say, eish, I only have 2 hours per month because of all the other activities that are happening. So as a result, this 20 hours is going to take me 5 months. So, hey, I can't afford to do this in 5 months. I'm going to go back and change this and that in my life so that I can accommodate more hours. Because that you do deliberate. One of the things that made me to stay married, by the way, after doing this thing, is that I had to sit down with my wife and say, look, I know for sure Sundays there's this thing of people working at the beach with your bicycles and looking all rich. But unfortunately for us, for the next 2 years, I can't do the beach on Sundays. Okay? Because all the other things would be out of the way. Sundays I'm going to sit and I'm going to work on these things. Then we agreed. So there was no expectation to say that, when are the Sundays, you don't longer do this, and because we spoke about it. So you wake up every Sunday, you already have a visa for 2 years, by the way, but not the visa to do all the other shenanigans. Ne? A visa to go to business school and then come back and then you do the sun. And then all it took is me planning to say now, based on the time and based on the fact that I'm expected to lecture and still do research, because as a lecturer, I remember one of the KPIs was to write articles. So I need to do articles and do these things and a whole lot of things during the week. I can't accommodate the week. And by the way, with us, I was attending every day. Our MBA, we're attending every day from 6 to 9. And you still have assignments and all these things over and above your mini dissertation. So there was absolutely no time during the week. Then Saturday, I was going to accommodate them. And Saturday, I chose Saturday because if there's any shopping to be done, we can do shoppings and so forth. So Sunday, please. Let's take Sunday. So it was an issue of, it was deliberate, because I realized that I'll not be able to do what I need to do if I don't actually allocate that Sunday. So I'm saying exactly the same thing to say that, you know, this thing is going to take 20 hours. You can't just leave it to chance. You need to go and find the hours, because you know, if you're going to do 2 hours per week, it's not going to work, because you need to finish this thing. And it goes back to what you said. You have 4 months a delay. So you need to now go back and then try to put everything, compress everything. So, for the purpose of this exercise, I'm choosing to work on the most likely time, right? But as I said, you choose your time and then you work accordingly. So how I get the times is an estimation, as I said. And you'll estimate because it's one item. Once you have the time, that's when you go back to this thing and you start allocating. All right. So activity number one, it's going to take 7 days. So I have it from day one to seven. The same with activity number two. The arrows will demonstrate which activity must follow which. And the arrows will actually show you which activities are going to be on the critical path. Because you know for sure, if you look at activity number three, in fact, let's say all the activities that start on day number eight. Can you see that? Excuse me, they will not start until activity number one and two are done. So, that's activity number three, four, five, and six. Yes, all those activities are waiting for one and two, meaning that one and two are very critical because they delay everything. However, go to day number 13 there. You'll see that day number 13, there's one activity that is running all the way to day number 13. The rest of the activities are finishing on day number nine. So these activities are not on a critical path, because if you delay them by a day, do they delay activity number four? I mean, the one that starts on day 14. They don't. You still have a buffer. Can you see that? So what it allows you to do is that if you have any delay, the activity to prioritize is that activity number three. So you know for sure I'm going to prioritize activity number one and two, activity number three, and then activity number whatever, that's seven, the interview list AD. Because that seven will delay the second last activity, comparative study. So all the other activities, the three activities there, that is your fourth, fifth, and sixth activities, are not on a critical path. those activities allow you to play around. You can actually leave them if you have issue with resources, any delay, as long as you complete activity number 3. All right. Now, but there's one flaw with this particular Gantt chart that I've actually displayed there. Can you see it? Okay. All right. That's not it, but I see what you mean. I see what you mean. That is just an issue of misalignment. So the biggest issue there is that if you look at the top, I still have day 1, 2, 3, 4 until day 34. And I just said to you that do not use that, because day number 7, for example, that's Sunday. Day number 6, if we assume that day number 1 was a Monday. Day number 6 is Saturday, day number 7 is Sunday. But if you look at my Gantt chart, I don't have a break, yes. I've assumed that I'm working all 7 days, which is a problem. You see? Because then eventually this thing was going to finish in time, but then the reality is I'm not going to be working every day. You see, which is why I said that when you do this thing, go back to your calendar. Because an activity that takes 7 days, for example, if you have 1 day per week to work on that activity, on your Gantt chart, that activity is going to drag into 6 weeks. Isn't it? Or 7 weeks. Yeah, 7 days, 7 weeks. So meaning that on your Gantt chart, you're going to actually have this long line on that first activity, because it's going to drag into all the 7 weeks. So you're not going to panic to say that this thing is taking you 7 weeks. Because if you really break it down, because that activity, you can actually do that. You can break it down to actually even to look at the actual day to say, I know for sure that I need to work on this activity on Wednesday at 2 o'clock. And that's what you do. You see, even though it's just 7 weeks, you know this, you're still on time. But then it becomes realistic, because remember, we're doing this as we're planning, colleagues. The difference between what we are doing and what we normally do is that we realize all these things as we are planning. Normally, we don't do these things. We realize this as we are implementing. And the problem is, as we are implementing, you don't have any room to correct. You understand? When you are planning, you can actually see, after you have done everything, to say, this thing is not going to take me 2 years. It won't take me 2 years. It's going to take me 3 years. Then you either make peace with it, or you go back and then find time. But the beauty of it, you are still planning. So eventually you can come up with a plan that suits your circumstances. Unlike finding out after 2 years to say, eish, this thing is not taking me 2 years. But it's too late. You see, it's way too late, because there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. Unfortunately in life, there's not that. You see that click, that arrow, undo. You can't click undo when... Unfortunately, if we could, I mean, most of us would be playing with that thing every single time. We'll be undoing. You see, there's no undo, there's no delete. You see. So that's why I always emphasize to say that do this thing. Be as realistic and as practical as possible, because it shows you to what extent are you going to finish this thing here. And then there's nothing wrong with you accepting to say, no, I make peace with the fact that this thing is going to take me 3 years. And I'm happy with that, and I'm going to live with that, and that becomes your plan. University will say, no, try to compress it to 2 years, you can do that and submit. But the reality is, when you go back to your plan, this thing, you know for sure, you've made peace with it, you won't be frustrated, you see. So that's how you do your Gantt chart, okay? And coming to the critical path, I'm avoiding it because of time, but there is a whole formula in terms of the critical path. I think I had about 20 slides on critical path in terms of determining it. But like I said, it's not so critical. I'm happy to share the slides with everyone. Then you can see the hidden slides. You can actually see the whole methodology of coming up with it. But the simple way of looking at the critical path is, as I showed you, to say that you can actually see, by way of looking at your Gantt chart, which activities are critical, which activities are not. Okay, you can actually see to say, no, this thing here, I can see for sure that if I delay number 3, number 7, 8, 9, and 10. Yo, bless you. I nearly ran away. Okay, activity number 7, 8, 9, and 10 are definitely going to be delayed. So, do I want a delay? No, I don't want a delay. So, you need to go back. And remember also, colleagues, one of the things that we can keep in mind is that this is your plan. Okay? There's no one forcing you to do it this way.
Mm.
You can change the plan as it suits you. You can decide to say it's activities in a series, so everything must follow each other, or there are certain things that you know for sure I'm going to do these things on this at the same time. And this is how I'm going to split myself, and this is how I'm going to do 1, 2, 3, 4. You see? So in my case, at some stage, as I said, I was having challenges in terms of my response rate. So I started running around and asking people to do that. But equally so, I actually asked a few students to say, no, look, this is my link, this is what I would like you to do for me. And then I actually now started running this thing in parallel, because I now have different people that are tackling different areas, and they were willing to do that for me and assist me. Okay, so now you can decide to say, now, well, I need these people, and if I need these people, what are the implications on a budget? How am I going to compensate them? Okay, and if you have the ladies, you have your husbands, you can always plan using your husband to say, no, I know for sure I'm going to tell him. He's going to have to run around and collect data for me. It's not debatable. There's no need for you to compensate him. It's given, you know. It's either collect or else. You know how it is, eh? It's or else. And once they say or else, then you quietly go to collect. You say, where is the data? What do I need to do? You just go and collect. From time to time, you know, like, they will emphasize, they will use their power, their authority to say, look, this is not debatable. You see, my wife doesn't debate with me in terms of what I wear, by the way. So that's how hectic it gets. To say, look, when you are wearing this shirt with this trouser and these shoes, and I say, no, eh. You are wearing this shirt, this trouser, these shoes. Then you walk out and, you know, and it's like that. It's extremely like that. For example, now I don't have a say in terms of my hair. I don't. I get in strict instructions. Whether I'm watching TV or whatever on a Sunday, go and cut your hair. No, I go and cut your hair. Then I have to see if I'm posting whatever I'm watching or whatever. But bottom line is that my hair has to be cut at that point in time. And then I get told to say, no, you need to cut it this way, and that way, and this way. It's or else. What are you going to do? Eh? It's or else. You know, in peace, some of these things you need to do for the sake of peace. Eh? Imagine calling your parents and your uncles because when you are refusing to cut your hair. The whole family is gathering to say, hey, this man is refusing to cut his hair. And then there's a whole fight. Ah, no, you just go and cut your hair. Eh? You know, you need to, yeah. So, we have 5 minutes before we go to lunch. So, let's see who's still awake, and whoever doesn't get this right does not go to lunch. Those of you who were there before, this is like when you keep your mouth shut. In fact, if I had duct tape, this would right, here's this farmer who came to town to sell watermelons. And he sold half of them plus half a melon. And when he did the stock take at the end of the day, he had one full melon left. How many melons did he have when he came to town? Are you thinking about it, or are you pretending to be thinking about it? Okay. Two different things. Yes. When you say, oh, it means we have the answer. Yeah, let's hear.
Try.
Okay, try.
He had 1.5 melon.
Okay, 1.5 melon. No, I'm not looking this side. 1.5 melon? Who has 2.5? 3. Okay, I have 3. I have 1.5. That side, the EFF. Nothing.
It's very tricky.
It's very tricky. Okay. Oh, you didn't have any melons. What do you think?
It's 1.5.
1.5. Okay. I think we have to vote, yeah? We'll have to vote. What do you think, sir? One and a half, ne? All right. You wanna try? Okay. How come three?
Because you can say he sold half of
them. Yes.
Which is
half of three?
Left with only one food. And perhaps is one and a half.
Yes. And half a melon. So that's what he sold.
No, you know what's the problem?
Hey.
Them can be people. And then plus half a melon. You didn't say he sold half.
Okay, so problem is them.
Yes.
Okay, you overanalyzed it. No, I see where the problem is. It's the technical requirements. You are right. So it is actually three because he sold half of the melons, which is one and a half. All right?
Okay.
And then plus half a melon, so then he sold two. So then it means, and it says when he did his stock take, he had one full melon left, so meaning that he had three. So you can have her plate and his plate and his plate, so you can have four plates. We are back. I hope we're not gonna fall asleep. We only have an hour. I've been told that. Huh?
IGs.
Well, we gave you Viennas because we thought Viennas would make you fall asleep. You see, if it was pap and modu and all these things, fortunately not. So, the last thing, okay, not the next thing, not the last thing. The next thing that we need to do is to allocate resources. Now, I did say that depending on your project, you might be using resources, you might not be using resources. So I normally cover these things because I don't know who's using or who's doing what project that requires resources. So I just basically go through this for the benefit of those who are using resources. In this particular instance, we're making an assumption that a resource is a machine or a person. And normally when you do your resource allocation, you do it after you've done your Gantt chart, your cash flow. And I have the CPM there. CPM is the critical path method, which I told you to say that I'm skipping for the sake of time. So your resource allocation, as I said, it's a machine or a person. We know that it can be money, but for the sake of this, we're going to put the money aside and we'll deal with the money separately. Now, in terms of a machine, you might find that you're doing resource, or you're doing experiments or lab research where you need certain equipment. So when you do resource allocation, it helps you to know when exactly do you need to actually hire that machine if you're hiring it, or borrow that machine if you're borrowing it, or I don't see why you would buy it, but in case you're buying it, when exactly do you need to buy it? When I was at UKZN, they decided to buy a machine to do a project. I don't know why they did that, but they did. The machine was called the Kronos machine. I don't know who came up with that name, but somehow that's what the name was. So it was called the Kronos machine. This the essence of the machine, or the purpose of the machine, was to measure eye movement. So they say it measures very, very fine, small eye movement. I don't know why you'd want to measure that eye movement, those eye movements, because they make no difference to how you see. So they say the theory is that as you're looking straight ahead, your eyes are moving micro movements that they needed to measure. But I mean, they are so insignificant, they don't really affect the way you see. You see albinos, the movements are very visible. Have you seen that? We call it nystagmus, where when they're looking, the movement is like that. So the assumption is that we also have the same movement. So with this movement, then they decided to measure this movement. I don't know why. And they bought a Kronos machine from Germany. So the Kronos machine arrived, boom, in South Africa, 500,000 rands later. And we started doing the project and blah, blah, blah. We went through the motions and all these things. Now, data collection. Guess what? The Germans forgot to tell us that the machine must come with a technician. So there's no one who can connect the machine, let alone use the machine. They say, no, you need a technician. Now, we have to decide, do we pay for a technician? Or do we sell the machine? And to cut a long story short, all I know is that the project was abandoned at some stage because they didn't have the technician to come and show us how to use the machine. Yeah, and then people who knew how to use the machine came to borrow the machine from us as and when they needed to collect that data. And they just came. I remember some ophthalmologists at Peter Maritzburg came to us and borrowed the machine and went away with the machine and brought it back. And now we bought the machine, which we didn't now know how to use, and we bought it way early in the whole thing. Whereas we should have actually also went and borrowed the machine when we needed the machine. So in this instance, we're doing resource allocation to know exactly when are we going to need our Kronos machine, and so that we can see how long are we going to need it for, and then we can make a decision whether we're going to buy it or rent it. I don't see why you would want to buy it for a project that is going to finish and you're only collecting the data, unless if you have a whole lot of projects that are lined up to use the same machine, which we didn't. So what happens is you go back to your Gantt chart. You look at your activities. Remember, activities are one items. So if you have one item, you already have estimated to say that you know the time. You say it's going to take me 1 day or 2 days. You can also allocate the resource. If it's going to be a person or a machine, you know for sure to say that I'm going to need two people. Okay. So for instance, you're going to do a classification of IK. It's classification. All you need to do is one person. You sit there, you do it. You don't need five people. Right. You're going to do identification of cultural villages. You know you need one person. You're going to pick up the phone and call Shakaland. You're going to need one person. You're going to do interview of Lisa. You're going to need one person. And so forth and so forth. I'll call them back. You're going to need to do interview on LISAID. You're going to need two people because we made an assumption that this is a physical interview. So you go through that and you identify the number of resources that you need. Okay, once you have done that, you then go to your Gantt chart and you'll see we're proceeding with it with the flow that it has in terms of day one up until day 34. So we say from day one to number day 7, you'll see that there are two activities running. Each activity needs one person each or one resource each, am I right? Now, if you look at that, you calculate it going downwards, you just add, you'll see that right at the bottom, I have two up until 7. So what it means there is that if I'm using these resources as a person or people, then what it means is that from day number 1 to day number 7, I'm going to need two people. Because I have two activities that are running at the same time. All right? So I know for sure, in terms of my resources, I'm going to need two people there to run those two activities. From day number 8, I'm going to need 4. Day number 10, I'm going to need 1. And day number 14, I'm going to need 10. So you go with it like that. What is the benefit of doing this? In some researches, depending on the complexity and the level of research, you'll find that you're using assistants. Okay, there's cost implication, am I right? If you're using research assistants, do you need to employ 10 as research assistants on day number 1? No, you need only 2. And if you are the other researcher, it means you only need one research assistant. Okay, now on day number 8, you need 4, so meaning that you need to employ 3. If this is weeks, you know for sure that I'm going to employ my people per week. If it's days, I'm going to employ them per day. So that you don't find yourself, the fact that you have now been given a budget to employ resources, you start calling people, hey, I need 17 people. You employ all the 17 and then they're idling, and then you just say, no, you know, these are my research assistants. Or you go to a department, if you're working in university, you've been allocated someone to assist you, you just want them next to you. But the reality is you are sitting on day number 8 or whenever, when you don't need anyone. You see, you're going to need this person on a specific day. So if you're employing them, you know for sure on the 14th day, I need to employ 10 people. This also assists you in cases where you're actually dealing with cash, because there are some projects where you find that you're going to be given tranches of money as when you go through certain milestones. So you know you're going to put your milestones such that you'll have enough money to pay these people on day number 14 when you need them. Because there's no point in setting up a milestone on day number 18. All right, when you need to actually have cash to pay 10 people, when you needed cash to pay 10 people on day number 14, but you didn't make provision for that. So you'll know for sure to say that I need these resources here. This is what I need to actually get the resources on board. This is when I need to actually get them on board, and so forth and so forth. And this is how long I'm going to need them for. Right? Does it make sense? If you go back to a machine, you know for sure if I'm borrowing a machine from this university, I'm going to ask them to make this machine available on this particular day, because this is when I get to that particular item. So that you don't find a situation where you've borrowed the machine, they give it to you today, but you only start using it in a month's time. In a month's time, they say, ah, Morena, you've been having the machine for too long. Bring it back. And you say, you understand, you're not going to have that. You now know, I don't need the machine now. You can actually even tell them to say, no, keep it for now. I'll come when I need it. You go in, you take it, you come, you use it, you take it back. If it's in a department, because in some instances, because of limitation of resources, you're doing research that the machine does not belong to that department, you need to borrow from another department in the same university. You just need access to the lab. You're going to go to them and say, I need access to your laboratory on this day. You see, then provisions are made. Then you actually don't have these issues of reputation where you are known to say, when I always say things, either you don't return people's machines or whatever the case may be, or you've been saying that you're coming, we know you're not coming because you're actually having these delays, you're having all sorts of things that are prohibiting you to come. But you told them in February already that you need access to the lab. And by the time you need access to that, they don't take you seriously. You understand? They proceed with whatever they're proceeding. So understand why the resource allocation. Now, in terms of the resource allocation, there's something called the resource histogram. So the histogram tells you to say that you have a limitation in terms of resources. So you might actually be needing 10, as we've seen on day number 14. However, can you get 10? So reality is you can't get 10, perhaps because there is a limit to what you can get. And the limit is created by the budget or the availability of resources where you are working or wherever is giving you support. So let's take an example here. Suppose I have 4. I know for sure that I have 4. But when I look at my histogram, I can see that on day number 21 there, I'm going to have an overload. And how do I come up with this histogram? I simply go to the numbers right at the bottom, which are in red, and I create a histogram from those numbers. Okay? Then when you create that histogram, you'll see that on day number 21, you need 5 resources, and then but you have 4 available. The red is the 4, is the availability. And on that particular day, you have a resource overload. So what do? You go back to your Gang chart. You have, let's say on that particular day, as an example, you have 4 activities that are supposed to be running. You move them either forward or backwards. You see, to say, no, I'm going to change this thing, I'm going to move these activities. In most cases, it's possible to move them forward. So you move them forward because unfortunately you can't do them because you have a limitation in terms of resources. So coming back to this, we can see that on day number 26, I need 2. So perhaps what I need to do, whatever activity is creating an overload just before, I'm going to move it forward. I'm going to do it on day number 26 because then I can still use the same amount of resources. Then again, you don't need to go and get extra resources when you have this. It applies for all type of resources, colleagues, whether it's a machine or whatever. The only trick is that what you do is that when you come to this particular table, you have to do that. I mean, you need to do a column for each resource. So you can't say 5, whereas in the 5 you say you need 1 machine and 4 people. No. You're going to have a column for people and a column for machines and whatever the case may be. All right. So then you understand in terms of what exactly do I need. Is that a question? Okay. You can understand to say what exactly do I need and where am I going to get it from and when do I need it. All right. Now, this is something just for interest sake. It's called a responsibility matrix. So this is saying, if you are working with people and you have this assistance that you're going to be working with, you need to make sure that as you assign responsibility to them, you need to use this matrix. So what the matrix is saying is that you can only make one person responsible for activity. You can't have 2 people responsible for 1 activity. Only one person can be responsible for for 1 activity, and the other person must be an assistant. This applies everywhere, even in home. To home, I mean, I have 2 kids. Once you tell them to do something together, it's a problem. Because they always point fingers. We always do it at work as well, isn't it? So we always need to make sure that there's one person who's responsible, because you can go and help that particular person accountable. Otherwise, when you have too many people, then it becomes a problem. So the metrics assist you when you have, let's say, 10 people or whatever the case may be. You just need to make sure that how you apply it is now. If you look at the X, is primary responsibility, and the dot is assistant. So you have activity number one. Now, meaning that in terms of the rows, activity one going that way, you can never have two X's. You can't, because what you're saying is that you have person A and whatever would be the next person responsible, because the X denotes responsibility. What you can have is a dot. The D is assisting person A on activity number one. All right? Excuse me, but what you can have going down in terms of columns, you can have two X's, because what you have said is that one person can be responsible for two activities. So if you look at person C, he's responsible for three and four. All right, that is possible. So you can't have X's that way, but you can have them that way. That is what the metrics assist you to do. The next one is a budget or a cash flow. Now, this one, I took it a simplistic view. We're not going to apply the budget the way we do budget in accounting, because all you just want to understand is that how much money do we need, if at all. Okay? So we're not going to be doing your budget the way you do it for those of you who did accounting, in terms of having your income versus expenses and having a section for variance and last year's budget and all these things. No, that is complex, right? So we're just looking at a cash flow. And we're looking to say that from this particular cash, how much do we need to do one activity? Again, I said earlier on to say that breaking down your project into small manageable pieces is the backbone of the project, you remember? Because once you break it down, you can then be able to do this thing. So remember, you break it down, you're going to be able to allocate time, you're going to be able to allocate resources. Now we can see that you'll allocate money. Because you know for sure, it's one activity, it's picking up the phone, calling this person, it's going to take me $10. You understand? It's not doing a whole package where you need to estimate. I mean, you go back to my example with Cape Town thing. I didn't estimate. I couldn't even estimate, because now I took it as a package. Had I estimated to say that I know for sure that, look, I'm going to do 500 kilometers. 500 kilometers, this is what I need to budget in terms of petrol. I'm going to stop. I'm going to buy... your quarter and this and chips and this and that. This is what I'm looking at. So I would actually arrive at a budget from here to Cape Town. So I didn't do that. So as a result, the whole thing was just guesswork, because I needed to just pay whatever I had to pay and then calculate after the fact. But in reality, life doesn't work like that. Okay. I was just lucky that I made it. Otherwise, imagine if I got stuck somewhere halfway because I didn't have enough cash, because I ran out of cash. That was going to be an embarrassment. And then the wife calls and says, "Where are you?" And I say, "Hey, I'm still trying to figure out the whole cash situation." It was going to be a problem. So normally you'd want to do this thing. If there are any cash implications, you want to do them ahead, but you don't want to thumbsuck. So if you break things down, you'll know for sure, this is what it's going to cost me. So let's take a simple example. You have activity number one, which you have budgeted 2,000 for. And you budgeted 2,000 because it's one activity, it's one action item. You know exactly it's going to take me 2,000 rands, the entire activity. I'm doing this activity per day. So every day I do this activity, whether I do it one day after the other, or every single day when I do the activity, I'm going to need $200. Because it's 10 days and it's 2,000 rands. All right? Simple arithmetic. Right, unless if I must give you time to take off your shoes and yeah, and then count. So 2,000 rands gonna take me 10 days, gonna be 200 rands a day. So if I go to activity number two, I do exactly the same, 3,000 rands, 300 rands a day. Activity number three, I do the same, it costs me 333, and the last one is 266. Those are my four activities that I'm using. That is my simple Gantt chart to demonstrate the point. Now, then I go, the same way I did resources, I go and I calculate. Now, from day number one to day number 10, I need 200 bucks every day because I'm running one activity, and I said that activity cost me 2,000 rands. Now, from day number 11 to day number 20, I need 633, reason being, I had 300 rands for activity number two, I have 333 for activity number three. You remember? Day number 21, I need 600 bucks because I had 333 and 266 for activity number four. So that is running up until day number 26, where I only need 266. Now, if you do like that, and then you add them all together, you have up until day number 29. If you add a column right after that, right at the bottom, and the total, you would add everything going that way. The number that you're going to find at the end, that is the amount of money that it will take you to run your project. That will be your budget. You see? So you don't have to thumbsuck it. And the beauty of this, you also know exactly how much do you need for each and every activity as and when you run it. So if you have your assistants, you're going to be paying them 200 bucks a day. And you know I'm doing this on a Thursday, and you have two of them. If you do it like that, you know that I need 400 bucks on that particular Thursday to do this thing. So if you're getting funded for the project, and as I said, depending on the complexity of the project and all these things, if you're getting funded for that particular project, you need to make sure that in that particular research account, on that day or on that particular month, that money is there. Because you're not going to run into problems. Okay, and I say this, we, as part of the innovation that we do at VUT, we approve people to come with innovative projects and we assist them to develop prototypes. So what they do is that they apply for a fund, and they provide a plan to say that how are they going to do their prototypes. Now, because they don't take time to really do this thing, what happens is then when we sit in a meeting to look at progress report, people will tell you that, no, I ran out of money. And they ran out of money because their money that they applied for, so they apply in tranches. So you find that people just come and apply for 50,000 rands because that is sort of the practice. To say that when you allocated 600,000 rands, every time when you go, every quarter you collect 50,000. So it's practice. So the collection is not tying up or is not aligned with the activities. So you have 50,000 rands and then you collect and then you go and do these activities, you run out of funds. Then you wait for the next meeting to go and justify why you couldn't do certain activities because you ran out of funds. But then if you look at how you withdrew, because it's so like this facility where you always withdraw, forgot the English word, a drawdown facility. So when they apply for a drawdown, they don't apply in conjunction with their activities. So the way it works is that when they apply for that drawdown, we transfer the money into their research accounts. So 50,000, boom, goes into their research accounts. But the activities that are lined up for that particular month or quarter are more than 50,000 rands. Had they done it this way, they would actually know that to say that when I go for this meeting to apply for a drawdown, I need 75,000 rands because I've calculated the activities that I need for this. So because it's done differently and there's a lot of estimation and so forth, it's a problem. And in some instances, they run out of the entire funding before they finish the prototype. So they come and say, look, I can't finish the prototype, I ran out of money. Then we now need to go to the research department and then ask research department to say, no, please advance us or give us another 100,000 rands because we have a prototype that is almost to be completed. Because when he first applied, the first application, remember at that particular application, people have the freedom to apply for whatever. They get funded by TIA. So you find that people, I think TIA funds up to 650, if I'm not mistaken. Now, they come up with this plan that asks for 550,000. And then TIA will actually approve what you've applied for. But you have not really given it thought because you didn't do this. Because if you did this, then you'd actually go and apply for the amount that you get right at the end there. You're not going to apply for the amount that you get in your mind. You see? So then you can actually go to TIA and say, I need 579,067 cents. because you know, then you actually add a buffer. Normally in project management, they'll tell you add about 10 to 15%, or you can even go 20% as a buffer to say that if I actually now have this and that, I can cover it with that buffer. But the amount of money that I need is 569,000 rands. I'm going to add 10%, which is about 56,000 rands. So I'm going to apply for 610,000 rands. Then you know you've covered. All right. Do you get this? Now, the control. The control, earlier on I said that you can actually take this thing and blow it. And I know some of you were thinking about bombs and stuff, C4. So so this is not C4 stuff. It's about blowing it and putting it in your wall. Or for those of you who are technologically advanced, you can use it from your laptop. So what you do, you need to go back to your laptop. And then if you're working on a weekly basis, you need to have a day where you go back to this thing and open it up and see how far am I from implementation, or at, in terms of implementation with regards to my project plan. Because what you do, you're trying to keep it in line with the baseline plan. You're keeping track on performance and deadlines. And in a way, you can actually start doing data capturing. Now, I just want to show you what I'm talking about. Sorry for the misalignment there. But what you have there is, now if you look at activity number one, this activity was supposed to run for 3 days. Now, let's say I am at the end of day number two, okay? Or I am the beginning of day number three. So I go to this thing here. I look to say that activity number one, it was supposed to be running, it's supposed to run for 3 days. At the end of day number two, this thing is only has only run for 1.5 days. It's 50% complete. It's half a day behind. If I'm doing it per day, activity number two, I'm not worried because it has not started. Activity number three, it's on time. Activity number four is not started. So at any given time, you are now able to chase your activities because you have this Gantt chart that is only comprised of activities. All you do is go back to activities and see how far are you from your activities, and you start pushing your activities. If it's a week, you know for sure that every Monday or every Tuesday, I open my Gantt chart, I look at my activities, and I fix whatever that I need to fix from last week. Okay, that way you're never going to be caught by surprises because you are on top of this thing, right? In fact, the information is always at your fingertips because at some point you're going to be knowing exactly what is outstanding on my Gantt chart. And you're going to try and fight time because you know for sure that you know what, this week I need to fix activity number 17. So I need to find time. So I have Tuesdays, but unfortunately because 17 is behind, I'm going to find a way I can do it on Wednesday so that I can bring it on par. All right? So what it means is we move from this. This is what you had to this. And this is on Excel. So if you look at that, right, this is just a summary of another project, right? But if you look at that, you have your activities there. Now you'll see the, what color is that? Is that yellow? Yes. Can I safely say yellow?
Yes.
Okay, right. Or is it baby yellow or what yellow? And so if you look at those yellows, those are packages. That is why you'll see that if you trace them, there's nothing on the other side of the yellows. It's only your work packages. But under the work packages, you then have activities. Now, then you'll see the next one said start. It's giving you a start date to say, when is this activity supposed to start? The number of days, the target, what is your target for that particular activity? The status, and the status, if you right look at the bottom, you'll see the key there. It will tell you that the green is on track, the yellow is missed, and the red is on not on track, and the blue is complete. So you know your status. The number of workers, those are your resources. You can add as many columns as you want on that particular sheet. Because you can add the money if you want the money. If you have machines, you can add machines and whatever the case may be. Now, when you open this thing up, it's on Excel. Boom. You know for sure that anything that is on green is on track. Okay. Then this is you. And remember, this is when you actually go and change the colors as well. You need to be honest to yourself. Remember, you are alone again. You don't have to cheat yourself. So you can put things on green. It's your sheet. After that, you can actually close the laptop. There's no one that's not, that's, there's no one that has to see that you actually have reds and all these things. So you can close your laptop, but you are honest to yourself. Because you've put it as red, then you know for sure that this particular red, I need to work on it. So there's the status there. It's telling you that that particular activity under purchasing on steel, at some stage it was delayed, but now it's complete. Okay. So that's how you track. Now I know in most cases, and part of why I included this sheet, is that in most cases people that think that because we have done a whole lot of things that seem to be technical, you need a software. If you want, if you have money or if the university is providing, you can use a project management software. But I can tell you now that it's very complex because it deals with your construction projects. It's a very nice software, by the way, but it's you need to actually figure it out. But you can use that project, I mean Microsoft project, all right? Once you capture this thing, some of these things it does automatically. So when as you capture your activities, you can actually set your predecessors, the duration. On the screen, you set your predecessor duration, blah, blah, blah. When you say enter, it will allocate it in the Gantt chart. It will show you where exactly is it. And you enter on project. The beauty of project is that you can allocate or you can indicate which days are you going to be working, how long are you going to be working, where are your holidays, and so forth. It will take all of those things into consideration. However, if you don't have access to project, you can do a simple Gantt chart on your spreadsheet. Now, then we go back to what you need to submit. Because remember, you did this for yourself. You are alone in your office and all these things. Now, we know in terms of submission, we always submit your work packages. All right? Now, if you take this thing here as it is, you've done it on Excel, and you only take the yellow. So you're going to collapse everything or compress. I don't know which is the English word. You know what I mean. Collapse, compress. We'll argue it one day. So you compress everything. If you compress, you remain only with the yellow. And you take the yellow as they are, you copy, you paste on your Word document, that becomes your project plan that you submit. Because the yellow is basically your work packages. They don't have to have detail. And that becomes that short thing that you always submit in your proposals. That mini scale. Right? So you submit that, and that's it. Then from there, you come back to your Excel. So you know for sure that when I work, I've submitted this thing on Word, which was a summary of my project plan. But the actual project plan is on Excel. So when you work, you're going to be working on Excel. You open Excel spreadsheet, boom, you work there. If you don't like Excel, you print this thing up on A3, you put it on your wall, and you know, start actually tracking it from your wall. As simple as that. Does it make sense? So we've just taken a simple thing, which was your Gantt chart that you submitted. We've added a bit of meat on it, and then we're going to submit it again, still as a Gantt chart, but we now can use it as a project plan to be able to now implement our projects. So in summary, we define the scope, right? We need to understand what is that we're doing. We break it down into small manageable pieces, because that's the only way you can manage it. You arrange it into a logical sequence of activities. Which one must follow which one? You develop a Gantt chart. You focus the required resources, if at all. You adjust and assign costs, if at all as well. And then you implement. All right?
Yep.
I think it's as simple as that. Simple as that. In conclusion, there is more to project management. This workshop only provided the key and relevant aspects of project management, and the aim was to introduce only those tools and techniques to effectively manage our research project. So you'll see that for those of you who did project management, I've skipped a whole lot of information on project management. I just went through the things that I thought that could actually assist us, and to say that what is it that we can borrow from project management and manage this thing. And I think if there's one thing that you take away from this, if you forget everything else, is your work breakdown structure. Okay, and that becomes everything, because everything follows from that. Your Gantt chart must follow from that. Your estimation must come from that. Everything that you do must come from your work breakdown structure. Your scope, I know in most cases, is just a matter of thinking about certain things that you didn't think about, like your technicalities, but in most cases you cover your scope when you think about your project, because you talk about your deliverables, you talk about your goals, you talk about your exclusions. Those are things that are basically your day-to-day activities that you talk about in academia. But I know in most cases you skip the work breakdown structure. So I'm saying that is your takeaway. If you forget everything, you forget my name or whatever the case may be, just work breakdown structure. All right. Thank you so much. My name still remains Maimokove. Nothing has changed. Those are my details. If you want to get hold of me, you can try those details. Cell phone doesn't normally work because in most cases I'll be doing something like this. And you might think that I don't want to take your call. So you're more than welcome to send me a WhatsApp or an email. and then you'll get hold of me. You can Google that company. That will also give you my details. Right. But if you have anything pressing, send me a WhatsApp. When I'm done with whatever I'm doing, I'll see it, I'll respond, and I can assist. Just to put a disclaimer as well, in most cases, people want me to assist because you are under pressure. You think I'm also under pressure. All right, so don't make your problems my problems. allow me some time, because I've had...
I'm saying my priority will never be your priority.
Yes, you see. So unfortunately, you find that I've assisted three students from the previous session that I did. But the unfortunate thing, and that's why I wanted to mention it, is that in most cases, someone comes to me now for assistance before Friday. You understand? It's not gonna work. Because remember, I'm not even the assigned supervisor. I was not even anticipating you to send anything to me. So I still need to find time and sit and really assist you. And unfortunately, if you're going to push it, you find that I'm not going to assist you having applied my mind. So just give me some time. If you know that for sure you need this in 2 weeks or whatever, I'll be more than happy to do that. And then when you communicate with me to say, look, I'm gonna email you this thing, please give it back to me in 2 weeks. I'll tell you at that time, 2 weeks is possible or these 2 weeks are bad, unfortunately, all right? So I just want to put that disclaimer out there because people think, this man is not reliable. Unfortunately, I'm trying as much as possible to accommodate where I can. All right, thank you so much, colleagues. I hope I did not make you fall asleep. we shall see each other next time. All right, thank you.